Monday night, and football fans from this vast metropolis are turning their attention to the home of football. Two teams are racing to the finals. Sydney have crossed the line. Melbourne need to win for any hope of action in September. A big crowd. The expectation of some electric football between two grand final aspirants. Seven Sports welcomes you to the MCG for round 21 action. It's the Melbourne Demons versus the Sydney Swans.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the MCG. The ingredients for a memorable night, fantastic weather conditions, a marvellous crowd, arguably the greatest full four to have ever played the game, and two sides, one fighting for a home final and a top four spot, and another just fighting to get into the finals. It's Sydney versus Melbourne, and maybe a big night for Plugger. Remember the last time he cracked the ton, 2 years ago?
Campbell, a big winner. Kelly pushes forward, taken by Grant. Grant chips to Lockett, he's got him. The moment has arrived. A magic moment. Lockett from 35 metres out. He's got it.
Here they come. Look at it. Well, they had no hope of stopping this, Bruce. No chance of stopping this crowd. Great performance by Lockett. Magnificent
achievement by Tony Lockett.
Well, if Plugger does it tonight and he's odds on to do just that, he's going to be joining an elite band of players to have joined the 100 Club right here at the MCG, including the great number five from Geelong, Gary Ablett, who did it back in 1993. It's all set up for a fantastic night, already a wonderful atmosphere here at the MCG, and you've only got to look at the ladder to know the equation, and it is rather simple. As I said, for Sydney, a win tonight, they're in the top four, they've got a home final. Melbourne, they're knocking on the door of the eight. The only problem they have is their inferior percentage. I don't think it's going to play a part. They just have to win. If they lose, of course, we look to round 22 and the final of the home and away matches. Melbourne next week plays Richmond and Sydney is at home to Collingwood.
The 1998 AFL Premiership season brought to you by Telstra, making life easier. Victoria Bitter for a hard-earned thirst. Cadbury Mark of the Year, McDonald's Double Quarter Pounder with Cheese and Mitsubishi Motors, the award-winning Magna.
So let's have a look at these two sides now. Melbourne and Sydney with Graham Corns and Jared Healy. Gentlemen, good evening.
Yes, good evening to you, Sandy. And there is a fantastic buzz here at the MCG. It is a final for the Melbourne Footy Club. The Swans looking to confirm their spot in the final four. It's a great atmosphere here, Graham.
Great atmosphere here. There's no doubt, Jared, a lot of interest around Australia, particularly in Adelaide, because if Sydney win, that means Adelaide has confirmed it.
I would have been disappointed if you hadn't mentioned Adelaide. But let's have a look at the Melbourne side. Shanahan obviously got the big job on Tony Lockett, but he'll need the likes of Uze and Woe Woden to drop down in front of Big Tony to fill the space, and I guess courage certainly required there. When Swartz, Neitz and Gaddy Lyon have been in the side together this year, the Demons haven't lost. So without Swartz tonight, an even money bet.
And the Sydney team, and there's just one player who's going to loom so much taller than all the rest. Tony Lockett in the goal square, 98 goals, 2 for his 100. The other player who's very important for Sydney in their forward line is Michael O'Loughlin, but only those two have kicked over 20 goals for Sydney this year. The midfield is where the balance of power should be exerted, and Wayne Schwoss back from a back spasm, Jared, you would know what that was all about, and Darren Creswell, they're the key players there. Their defence isn't bad, but statistically really only the eighth best defence in the competition, so a battle of midfields.
Yeah, I'm not sure what you mean by that, Coins, but Tony Lockett, well, he's been here 26 times for 138 goals. He's averaged 5.3. What a superstar he has been. A genuine icon of the game. We'll come back after the break and find out if Big Tony can kick his 100th goal in a season for the sixth time.
Welcome back to the MCG. Tony Lockett and Wayne Schwoss in front of him having a few words. A cool, pensive Lockett. Set to go. And set to kick his 100th goal for the sixth time in his career. Did it three times with the Saints in 87, 91 and 92. And then in Sydney when he made the move north in 95. He kicked 110, also won the Club Championship Award in 96. One man not playing tonight, unfortunately, for Melbourne is David Schwartz, but he's on the boundary with the king of the riders. Dipper, good evening.
Thanks very much, Sandy. Good evening to you too. And David, you'll certainly know the destinies of the club tonight.
Yeah, certainly. If we win, well, we're in the finals. If we lose, we've got to sweat on next week. And the boys were pretty pumped in there, and I haven't seen it like that for a long, long time.
What's been the main focus this week after that great win against Port Adelaide?
Just to prepare well, to be to knowing that we're playing a different time and a different day, just to really be solidly prepared.
You got about three or four players who have played under 40 games. How have they handled it?
Yeah, well, big step for a lot of them, but they're up to it.
And for yourself, you'll be back next week?
Yeah, hopefully, if everything goes well.
Thanks for joining us on Channel 7, Sandy.
Thanks, Dipper.
Good on you, Dipper, and good luck to David next week. We welcome our fourth umpire, Johnny Russo. John, good evening.
Good evening, Sandy. And if you can't get excited about these do-or-die struggles at the end of the season, there's something wrong. It's going to be a fantastic game tonight.
And, Sandy, Tony Lockett has started deep in the forward pocket, right out in front of the member stand. Quite interesting.
So here we go. Up against his old teammate, Jamie Shanahan. But at the moment, it's White and Stafford out of the middle. Viney slaps it back, pushing it down towards half forward. Sydney, incidentally, won the toss and are kicking to the right of screen. Cook, unable to take it cleanly, has assistance in Ruse. Paul Ruse looks down towards the area that Graham Corns was talking about. Lockett has dropped back, and it gives Melbourne a chance to clear through Uze, back towards centre wing, only as far as Johnny Stevens. Stevens gets the hand pass away to Rowan Worf. Worf kicks blindly down towards the half forward line, and big Jeff White is there.
And it was good midfield pressure there by Jeff Farmer that caused that kick to go blindly. And, well, Jeff White dropping back into the hole. At times tonight, he's going to have Tony Lockett charging through that hole, so courage required.
Leoncelli kicks towards half forward. Meets was there, but a good mark taken by Matthew Nix. Had a marvellous season for Sydney, his Knicks. He kicks down towards half forward. Wayne Schwoss was a late withdrawal last week, back in this week, taken over the line, and a throw in on the outer side.
Sandy, just to keep you up to date with their benches down here, McPherson for Sydney, Mooney, Saddington, and like Lucuria. And for Melbourne, we've got Steins, Cow, McDonald, and Collins.
Having a look at them as you speak, Dipper, thank you. Stafford, who one feels really is a key for Sydney. Cook hugging the boundary line, going in towards Lockett and Shanahan territory. There's a wall in front of Big Plugger.
Yes, you can see pretty quickly that Neil Danaher has instructed the likes of Ingerson and Phoebe to just, every time Swans get the ball, to drop back, zone in front of Tony Lockett.
Here goes Melbourne through Magoni, looking up towards the forward line. A high bomb up towards full forward, towards Gaddy Lyon, pushed over defensively for one behind. The first score of the night going the way of the Demons.
Yes, and young Jeff Farmer very quickly to the foot of that pack. He was looking for the loose ball, but it looks like Mark Orchard's actually picking him up out there.
Boys, who are your selections tonight? Graham, firstly?
I've gone for Melbourne simply because it's the home ground.
Jared?
I'm with Graham. Just a toss of the coin, and it's landed Melbourne.
And John?
Melbourne as well, Sandals.
Stevens in the back pocket.
Seacamp's playing on Paul Ruse.
And it's coming to that pair now. Almost ricocheted off Rue's head. He gets a second chance. He sockers it down towards centre wing. Only as far as Phoebe, though. That was Stephen in towards half forward, but big Greg Stafford is there. It's been a key. They need him fit, Greg Stafford. He's kicked into a nest of Demon players, though. Cook come bursting through, and he sockers off the ground. If it sits, Sydney may be in business. He's right on the 50. The hand pass not quite high enough. He's going to have to go again. Melbourne will clear, and they steady it down towards centre wing, where Phoebe takes the mark.
Great work by Anthony Ingerson, just to get the hand on it. Let's set up this counter-attack.
This is Matthew Phoebe, kicking down towards left half forward. It's been a good tight opening, one we would expect between these two sides. Robertson is outside 50. He's in two minds, goes onto the left foot, a centering kick. But the mark is taken timely by Matthew Nix.
Important in these matches just to play the percentages pretty early. And we saw there Russell Robertson just trying to do a little bit too much and kicking it directly to the Swans.
Maxfield on the outer side to Wayne Schwoss. The Swatter looks down towards O'Loughlin. Built like a piece of 8-gauge wire, but highly talented. Leaping Leo Barry's got it 80 metres from home. Here comes Plugger. Look out! Shanahan is right there with him. Jeff White tidies up, gets the hand pass away to Phoebe. By G, this is tight. Phoebe comes back in towards the middle. Good kick. Mark taken by Nix. Oh, play on was the call. And they do. Tingay's going to be able to tidy up. He's got it on left half four, taken from Woden. Two bounces from Tingay. Three. He's still going. He takes on Orchard, and he's going to get a free kick. Too high.
When the player's running straight at you, Mark Orchard did the right thing. He planted his feet. And Tingay, well, too high.
And don't tell me Tingo's not pumped for this game.
Oh, you've got to take him around the waist. And DeMarco Orchard did everything right except tackle around the waist.
But you can tell that the adrenaline really has taken over a number of the demons. Tingo just had no other option going through his brain except charge.
It was going. Okay, so he's given it to Farmer. And the Wizard from 47 metres pulls it away to the left. There's Jeffrey Farmer.
Well, he's very important for Melbourne because they've got those two or three big players who are their key forward line players, but they need somebody at ground level who's got quick legs, sure ball handling, and knows where the goals are. Jeff Farmer knows all about that.
Cook is put under a little bit of pressure here. Donald tried to get it out. Well, Woden does. Here they go. Straight into the open goal. Go, Rogundi! Guy Ragone came into this game with an awful kicking record for the season. 4 goals, 10, but he's on target so far tonight. Johnny Stevens out of the centre for Sydney. Up towards half forward. Maxfield takes on a couple and Stewart has taken the ground.
And good midfield pressure. And particularly good pressure across half back for Melbourne. You notice they're getting players back. They do not want to get that ball down to Tony Lockett. And they're trying to just stifle the forward movement of Sydney through the midfield.
And speaking of the midfield, strange that Darren Creswell started that bounce at centre-half forward. He's been picked up by Leon Chelli.
Perfect conditions. Stafford, again, can't get a clear tap wide. He's pushed towards the line. Phoebe almost taken high. And, in fact, the umpire said that it wasn't high, it was a push. So the advantage is going to be paid. It's taken by Woden, centering into half forward. Towards David Neitz. Troy Luft got the big job there. Luft picks himself up, tries to get clear.
High tackle paid, Sandy.
And he's going to get the free kick. The men in white tonight are Chris Mitchell, Hayden Kennedy and Scotty McLaren. A couple of teachers and a pharmacist looking after proceedings. Dale Lewis. Down towards half forward. O'Loughlin.
Well, he's so dangerous. Oh,
sensational to watch now. Look at this. In towards Plugger. This for number 99.
Sandy, it was just on the right side of his body. Shanahan was standing on his left. The kick went to the right side. He didn't have to do too much, just turn the body. And the kick doesn't have to be any more precise than that when you've got a big, strong, talented player like Lockett. Plus, he gets a very good look at the goals from that pocket.
As Jared said, he's had 26 games here at the MCG for a total of 138 goals. So his average here is above his career average just. Averaging 5.3. So Sydney looking for their first goal, but he's pushed that right across the face. The mark's been taken by Barry. Just inside the line.
And being a left footer, he's a chance to kick this.
Plays on and slams it into the woodwork, goes Leo Barry.
Yes, he put himself under all sorts of pressure. Jared, I'm not sure whether you have to play on, particularly for a left footer from the pocket. The pockets of the MCG aren't particularly deep. Just the act of playing on just puts you under too much pressure, perhaps.
In fact, I think that far side has been opened up a bit, hasn't it, with the movement of the goalposts in recent weeks. But nonetheless, behind is the result. Melbourne lead with just the one goal on the board at the moment. And the Phoebes will bring it back in. Stephen hasn't missed a game this year, but this is Matthew. Into half forward. To Leoncelli. Good smaller. Leoncelli may get another chance to go again. Although Cook might have something to say about that. Stafford goes for the little chips. Okay to Dale Lewis.
Well, it's Troy Cook's bustling style. You can tell when a player's trying and really busting to make the contest. And Cook is proving to be pretty important. Kelly's not available these days, but you just get somebody who makes the contest, forces the error, and got it out there to Stafford, who had good vision.
Dale Lewis could prove to be the wild card for Sydney after a great year last year. He's been fairly quiet.
Has kicked 12 goals so far this season. That looks pretty good. Right on the line. Right on the line. Sensational stuff. Away comes Ragone. We couldn't have asked for a tighter start. Viney. Been an inspirational skipper. Off to Jamie Shanahan, who's drifted away from Plugger. They're out of trouble relatively easily now. Seacamp gives it away to Ingerson. Ingerson looks to Shane Woden. He's on centre wing. The left footer is wide, too wide, and it's going to spin over the line.
And Sandy, Melbourne haven't completely dispensed with that possession game that people were so critical of last year. They just give the opportunity of turning the ball over just by that one handball extra at times.
Neitz did the rucking work up against his opponent, Luff. Ruse gets a bad bounce. Neitz goes again. May have gone a little high, said the umpire, John.
Yeah, that's what he paid it for, Sandy. Certainly paid it for high contact.
Well, I think, Graham, the difference between the possessions of Melbourne this year and, I guess, in previous years, once they get it towards that midfield, the centre wing, they do try and get it long and deep into their attacking area.
Ruse to centre wing. No mark taken by Ingerson. Lyon was ready to take the hand pass from Steve Tingo, but he goes it alone. Tingo kicks down towards Neitz. Use the body against Lewis. Sydney have the players there. It's Orchard back to Ruse. Over to Luff. Slightly proppy, but he's got time to chip to Stafford. The big man's got Creswell running past. He elects to go wider and longer. To the outer side he goes, and Rowan Wolf's got a hit there. One bounce, and Rowan is through the middle. Long. Here comes Lockett again. Same spot.
Well, it is perfect for a right-footed full forward. If you're going to leave that forward pocket vacant, they'll kick there every time. No pressure in front of him. He's able to run onto the ball, and with the right leg, he has plenty of opportunity to slot it.
Great kick from Rowan Wolf, and once again we see that it's not going to be Jamie Shanahan that stops Tony Lockett. It's got to be the other defenders dropping into the space.
From 45 metres, he leans back on that, and this time is away to the left. Another behind.
Well, is there a touch of nerves there? We're used to seeing him ice cool, but he would know that he only has two goals to go for his 100. There'll be a bit of pressure and stress upon him until he actually gets there. And those two shots at goals that he's had, not greatly confident.
5 points the margin. Melbourne leading. The one goal coming from Guy Ragone in the opening few minutes. Jeff White's the target of this kick out.
It was a good setup, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was great.
Looking pretty good at the moment, the D's, as White gives it to his captain. Viney looks down towards half forward. Neitz could be the flyer here. He is David Neitz, but he couldn't take it. The Wizard can't get clear. They're ripping into him.
High tackle paid.
Yeah, they just dealt with him too heavily, John, when he hit the ground, didn't they?
Yeah, it looked as though he was grabbed high as he went to the ground, so that was certainly the signal given by the umpire. Here we see it again.
You see Orchard comes in.
Orchard jumps over the top, and that's what it's been paid for, that late contact by Orchard that was above the shoulder.
Yeah, actually, we're blaming Mark Orchard. It was actually Brad Seymour, so Mr. and Mrs. Orchard would be pretty pleased if we could clarify that.
Well, fortunate to get away with that, Melbourne. They've relied on just the long bomb to Neitz. Melbourne and Sydney have also been dropping a number of players back across that area to crowd him out.
Farmer from 48 metres. He gets underneath it. It's going to be very, very close. He's just made the distance. Jeffrey Farmer has his first. White is a mighty flyer in the middle. O'Loughlin could cut across over Sydney. Bends it round towards Troy Cook, who's made a very aggressive start. So too is Tingo, who cracked into him there. Good stuff.
Well, both teams have come to play. You sense that Melbourne have settled just a little bit earlier. They're certainly desperate. And you wonder about the pressure of having to play to make a final or to grab a home final, whether it just puts too much stress on a team.
I wonder also, Graham, whether psychologically it can work the other way for Sydney. They're there, and they know there's next week too when they take on Collingwood at the SCG.
It's that case of whether the team is too highly aroused, whether the team just goes out to play football. But Melbourne seem to have started the better of these two teams.
On centre wing, Stafford in front. Woden does the roving work. Shane's kick goes past Neitz. Belt or Farmer almost was away. Seymour gets a hurried kick to O'Loughlin. That's okay. Michael O'Loughlin can chip down towards right half forward. Barry's a long way out. But it'll swing inboard the left footer. Around Ingerson towards Lockett, who's caught at the back. Again, they had a wall in front of him, but he's got front spot now. Off he goes to Cook. A centering kick for Troy Cook. Anita Market full board. Schwass was the flyer. Uze is the defender. And White is the receiver. They're out of trouble once again.
Great recovery by Adam Uze.
And good running by Leoncelli to give him that option.
He's off. Back to Uze again, who bends one around his body. Phoebe's in a spot of bother there. That was Matthew. Eventually gets a high kick up towards half forward. Luff in front of Neitz.
David Neitz has probably got to create some space and move into it. He's a far better player when he runs and jumps at the ball rather than trying to play off someone like Troy
Russell. Troy Luff's had a pretty good season. He hasn't missed a game for Sydney. Stewie Maxfield. An interesting attempt to get a kick away down towards Dale Lewis, but beaten for it by Gergic. Down towards right half forward. Again, it's a cruel bounce. The Orchard hand pass is going to be okay for Sydney. They'll come steaming away. Seymour gets the hand pass off to O'Loughlin. Michael O'Loughlin wants Plugger. Well done by Jamie Shanahan. Hit him to the ball. They've got the hand pass away to Skipper. Ragone goes through the centre. Look out! Hospital hand pass. Back to Ragone again. They swoop on him. Meeks couldn't take it cleanly. Luff's in trouble. Robertson tries to throw it out. Back to Ragone it goes. Down to full forward. Dudley takes a punt with a bounce. And it's going to be all right. What about his kick? It's high and it's wide and it's well marked by Phoebe. Matthew Phoebe's away. 70 metres out. Kicks towards Robertson. How long can this pressure be withstood? Dudley, nice little spin. Finds Luff. Out they come. Nix from half back in towards the middle and Dale Lewis. He's attacked from the side, but he gets his kick. He pulls it towards Stafford.
And it's a good move bringing Stafford into the forward line because it draws Jeff White out of the space of Tony Lockett.
You're right, G, and he was off. And he's now going to have a shot from the right forward pocket after having a couple from the left.
And a very good pass from the big man, too.
Well, this is perhaps his toughest shot of the evening. And I guess the only difference between two sides has been the inaccuracy of Tony Lockett. You're right, this one will probably split the middle.
So if you've just joined us, he's still chasing his 99th goal for the season. Metres out. It's a good kick. Sensational kick. He's on the way. Number 99 is in the bag. Sydney closed the gap to 5 points. Jeff White again sensational out of the middle. And look at Shane Woden. Read it like a book and goes down towards full forward. This is dangerous for Sydney. The reply could come very, very smartly. Robertson round the body from behind.
Tenny to go. Gorgoni just took himself off the ground here because he has two dislocated fingers. He's just been attended to now by the doctors.
Two dislocated fingers.
Two of them.
Well, one you can handle, Jared, but
in some pain
two, I'd imagine, would be a little bit sore.
Neil Curley sort of comes into mind, doesn't he?
He's had 10. Curls will be watching. We hope you're enjoying it. Nix goes to the outer side and finds Dale Lewis.
I think Melbourne have got to find another option up forward. Yeah. Rather than just bombing the ball to Gary Lyon, Dunkley is such a great body player that you've got to try and expose him on the lead. They're giving the space to Lyon, but they're not kicking it into that space.
Yeah. They do miss the man wearing the number 5 Guernsey, David Schwartz, who we spoke to prior to this game starting, and he hopes to be ready for next week. O'Loughlin was set up, and it's belted away from him, straight to Love, who bombs it. He bombs it towards Lockett. There was holding on from both of them, so play on was the call, and now a cry of ball. It finishes with Uze, well smothered by O'Loughlin. Schwartz can finish it off for O'Loughlin.
Touched
off the boot and taken through from behind. Yeah. But some great individual efforts there.
If you've ever wanted to see desperation to hold a football in the forward line area, that's what coaches love. Forward line players fighting with tackling and smothering, and the ball stayed there. The kick wasn't quite clear or clean enough, but the ball is there, not in Melbourne's forward line. Just watch what Michael O'Loughlin, he's smothered. He's gone straight at the feet. Straight at the feet and copped the knee in the back of the head as Adam Uze stumbled over him.
You great mentioned carry. Uze, that's his target. Phoebe's bringing it back in. Game number 68 for Adam, and he's had a full season with the club. Sneaks a few metres and looks towards centre wing. Jeff White pushed from the side. Didn't get a shove. It's all right because Viney goes steamrolling through. Steams away from Johnny Stevens. Kicks down towards full forward. Again, it's just bombed away, though. Dunkley took a bit of a punt. Orchard is there, but the Wizard is quick. Robertson is right there with him. But watch the Wizard. Around he goes. Boot to ball, and he gains 25 metres.
Yes, Jared's point is very, very valid, Sandy. They're just not giving Gary Lyon any opportunity whatsoever. He doesn't have quite the flexibility or athleticism, but Farmer working very hard to keep it in the forward line. If follows it, just scoops it up nicely, tackled, gets it on the boot, but they have to find a bit more space for Gary Lyon and then give him a better look at the ball when it comes in.
Maxfield over the line, another throw in on the outer side with just over 5 minutes remaining.
This time it's Jeff White to drag Greg Stafford away from the ruck duel. White just pushing down to some 25 metres out from goal. Maybe the Neil Danaher wants him to go down there and take a mark.
Troy Cook's floating hand pass has made it tough for Stewie Maxfield. So Woden does the Ronnie Biggs and he steals it down towards half forward. White just tries to flick it on to Phoebe. Almost was perfect. Tingo's on the end of it, but he's back towards the centre. Ducked his head once, so play on. And he does. Wider towards half forward and McDonald. In trouble. Goes back again to Uze. Scooped it up beautifully with a one hand. He can have a shot at goal at him, Uze. 40 metres out of his touch. And one behind.
Melbourne taking every opportunity to play on so they can chip the ball around and just trying to find that loose man up forward. At the moment, the Swans are certainly handling that situation.
They are flirting with danger, though, by that extra handball. They wanted to get away.
Here's Brad Seymour at halfback. Stevens will lurk towards the centre. Dale Lewis backing into the pack, unable to take the mark. It appeared to be a whistle. Maxfield plays onto Lewis. Dale Lewis onto the left foot. O'Loughlin will be the target at the back. Pushes down in front for Lockett. Lockett's got it. Gets the hand pass away to Stafford. Unselfish play. Stafford fires at goal. And again, hits the woodwork. Oh, what drama.
Well, just goes to show what a talented player Brent Gergic is. He was gone there for all money, but he decided to just rush the player with the ball, the big ruckman Stafford.
Do you ever subscribe to the theory of the old adage, never handball to a ruckman, Gerald? Was that one of your football adages?
Yes, never handball.
There's Farmer. Uze, I should say. Adam Uze. In towards halfback, and Jeff White, who's a young man in a hurry.
I think if there was an exception, though, Cornsy, Stafford with so much skill would probably be it.
Down towards McDonald, who can run on here. Can he goal from 25 metres? Yes, he can. Troy Cook off the ground and seems a little distressed by it. And coming on for Sydney is Paul Lecuria. Mooney was preparing himself, but Lecuria made his way out. Stafford to half forward. Ruse over the top. They pounce on it as Marcus Seacamp attempts to escape without success.
Sandy, Troy Cook just took himself off the ground there. He's hurt his ankle. The doctors are now looking at it.
Thanks, Dipper. Let's hope he's okay. Lewis tries to do it on his own. Big ask. Schwoss has been fairly quiet at the moment. Ruse kick is wide. Stevens will be first to it. He's a left footer. He gets the hand pass away towards Nix. Centering kick now. Lockett and Shanahan at it once again. But there forming the wall is Mr. Ingerson, and he does it well.
Great courage, Anthony Ingerson. He had to back back. He knew Lockett was coming. Kept his eyes on the ball.
Woden's kick is wide. Creswell has a chance to send Sydney back into attack. Chips to Schwoss. Had it spent a little too early. Fortunately for him, he's got support. Barry, the left-footed Leo Barry. Runs a long way, but it's a poor kick.
They paid an advantage then, John. Was there an advantage? That's not,
well, the free kick was paid for a sling after disposal, and if the Swans player elects to run, then the umpires will give him the opportunity to do that. He elected to keep going, so they'll permit that to happen.
Once again, it was just fantastic midfield pressure by Melbourne on the ball carriers for Sydney that forced them to kick it long and kick it errantly. And Melbourne have been given time to drop those players like Ingerson and Gergic and Seacamp, for that matter, back into the hole.
Leoncelli gets another 25 metres. 11 points the margin. Luff and Neitz to do the ruck work.
White going White, to centre-half.
Yep, with Stafford.
And Leo Barry, who's centre-half forward and being picked up by Anthony Ingerson, is trying to drag Ingerson right out in front of the new southern stand to get him out of Lockett's way.
Saddington preparing to come on too for Sydney in the last couple of minutes of this quarter. Just in Sydney's attacking zone. Seacamp to Viney. Viney's hand pass drops a little short, but Stephen Phoebe's equal to the task. Here's a chance now for Melbourne again. down towards full forward, but Gaddy Lyon, a big ask for him. There's a great tackle. Hurled up, says umpire Chris Mitchell, and he'll come in for a bounce.
He's a great player, Gaddy Lyon, but he just cannot go man on man with Dunkley. But gee, what a tackle. What a tackle.
You were going nowhere. Absolutely nowhere.
Just for curls back in Adelaide, there was no prior opportunity.
Still in the danger zone as far as Sydney are concerned, as Lyon tries to keep it in without success.
And Jared, he's not quite moving with the same leg speed in previous years, is he, Gaddy Lyon?
No, he's lost a fair bit of pace, there's no doubt about that. But I think as this game slows down a bit, you've got to just, I guess, accept that it is being played at breakneck speed at the moment. Gaddy Lyon will come into his own more.
Rigotti's just coming back out onto the ground as Dunkley's taken over the line.
He's also very much on the end of the kicks, as we've said, and the pressure is so immense in the middle of the ground. I guess it's impossible to expect the kicks to be pinpoint passes.
Robertson in towards Farmer and co, but it's melted defensively over for one behind.
Well, the game is evenly poised.
Free kick's been paid against Jeff Farmer for holding that contest.
So that'll be Orchard. We'll bring it out to Nix. No addition to the score. He comes towards Stafford. The big man is so casual, but so talented. To Stevens and Worf. Well, he's got 22 seconds there to add to the score in this first quarter. Rowan's looping hand pass goes towards Troy Love. Off he goes to Dale Lewis. Lewis goes in towards the pocket. O'Loughlin is there, and he takes a good mark. Well, he's going to go for goal. It's long. It's a great kick. What a kick by Michael O'Loughlin on the siren.
Fantastic individual effort there just to knock Gergic off, but I'm not sure, Cornsey, whether you thought this, but I reckon Melbourne just took the pressure off for the last 30 seconds. It's cost them a goal.
It's hard to know, but for all Melbourne's apparent dominance, the game very evenly poised.
Absolutely.
It's quarter time here at the MCG. Melbourne lead 3-3 to Sydney's 2-4.
From the home of football, this is the second quarter between Melbourne and Sydney.
And if it's half as good as the first quarter, we're in for a belter. 5 points the margin at quarter time in a tight, low-scoring start. 3-3 Melbourne, Sydney at 2-4.
Seven Sports. Hope you're enjoying this match in the 1998 Coca-Cola AFL Premiership season.
And we certainly are enjoying it. Fabulous first quarter. Plenty of pressure absorbed by both sides, Jared.
Yeah, I think Rodney Ede would be pretty pleased with the position of the side at the moment because Melbourne did throw everything at them. And Dippers down on the boundary line with the assistant coach of Melbourne, Greg Hutchison.
Yeah, thanks very much, Gerard. Greg, are you happy about the pressure in that first quarter?
Oh, the pressure's been great, Dipper. The forward line pressure, it's been fantastic. We've kept it in there a few times and it's what we expected from a pretty tight game.
Have you changed the forward setup at the moment?
Oh, not really. We've still got Neitz, Lyon and Robertson down there, so we're happy with that. And Farmer trying to get to the drop of the ball there.
And you're happy about the way the backmen are holding Lockett there?
Yeah, well, they've done a good job so far, but there's a fair way to go yet, Dipper.
Thanks, Hutchie.
No worries.
Yes.
Good point, eh, Sandy? Fair way to go yet.
It certainly is, Dipper, yes. And he's just sitting precariously on 99. Jamie Shanahan, his old teammate down at Moorabbin, has the job on him. Plugger had a couple of shots from the left forward pocket, was unsuccessful. Put one through on the right. Mate. Second quarter here at the MCG.
Major possession winners. Dale Lewis had nine and Shane Woden had 11 possessions.
Here's Michael O'Loughlin, his hand pass somewhat thwarted. Jeff White did well. That slews off the side of the boot, going wide to the outer side. McDonald leads O'Loughlin in the race for the ball. Pokes it in towards the 50, was looking for Robertson. Seymour's right there with him. Lyon late on the scene. Kept in play by Sydney. Rowan Wharf can take this away, and he does with a high punt kick back towards centre wing. Schwoss was at the bottom of Uze.
Free kick paid for a push in that marking contest, Sandy.
Well, he fell on him, didn't he? Good contest this, between these two.
Yeah, both just after the footy and then just unfortunately fell on top of him.
Uze certainly had the better of him in the first quarter, Graham.
Yes, and I'd be most impressed with Adam Uze's start. But ominously, Schwoss can get better.
Saddington to Barry, but it's coming back and it's going the other way.
50 metres.
Well, he must have felt that the Swans didn't realise that the free kick was going Melbourne's way, so the 50 won't be applied.
Well, it's a sensible interpretation.
Yeah.
So Ingerson will still go via the cape. Around he comes to Todd Viney, who from fullback says to Jeff White, get your skates on. Poor kick. Stafford O'Loughlin almost scoops it out.
Free kick for a push. And Sandy, look, I agree with you, he did scoop it out, but again, we've got to bear in mind where the umpire was. He was on the inside of play and wouldn't have been able to see what O'Loughlin did with that footy.
He shouldn't have had to. Jeff White let that ball bounce. It was only a metre in front of him. He just had to make the extra yard and dive for that chest mark.
Barry couldn't quite complete his acrobatics. Viney ducked his head. Barry tried to go through again. Lockett at the back. He's ripped to the ground. He tries to sucker it. He goes again, big plugger.
Well, pretty keen on getting his
if you've ever seen a rugby ball where they put the boots in and try and rip the ball out, that was about as close as you're going to get to it in Aussie rules.
And he's having a wry smile about it too. Well, he's within metres of kicking his 100th. What can they do? Barry decides to take them on. Uze is there. Oh, Gergic also.
Great pressure, Sandy.
Fantastic. Schloss over the top. Gergic out the back. Where's it going to land, though? Ragone. The diving guy, Ragone, takes it. Melbourne do well to get it out of that zone. White shows great agility and a worm-burning pass in towards David. It's all Feeney. Up without it, opens the door for Luff. He gives it to Creswell, also quiet in the first term. He was well held. Lewis could have been praying. He loses the ball, but only for a moment, as Creswell marks again on centre wing. Just a couple of kicks in the first quarter for Darren Creswell. Goes in towards the forward pocket region. Barry was the diver. Ruse is ripped away from it. Didn't have the ball. Lewis has taken the ground. Seacamp asks the question. And again, comes in.
Paul Ruse perhaps a bit unlucky there.
Yep. Well, I certainly don't think it was a free kick to Ruse because he has the footy and then just he's actually doing a fair bit of holding on Grigic himself if you had a look at that tackle. Grabbing the arm, making sure Grigic can't let go.
Ruse, a short kick, pushes it down towards centre wing. Could be a clash here, although Meeks is first to it. Bends it round the body, up towards the right half forward. There's a wonderful mark taken by Robertson.
He knows how to mark this boy. He just can't quite finish his work off with his accuracy and his kicking.
Russell Robertson's kick towards Gary Lyon. Duckley is there as well. Pushed towards the line and over for a throw in the right forward pocket.
Danny, just to keep you up to date with the benches, Troy Cooker, ankle at the moment is 50-50.
Let's have a look at this other one.
Yeah, Ruzzi's actually grabbing Grigic's arm there and certainly didn't want it to look as though he was being let go. So I'm comfortable with the play on there.
I think you're very kind of the umpire there, John.
Kick was smothered. McDonald is also smothered, and Seymour. But there's been a whistle. There's going to be a free kick. Right in front.
And well, Hayden Kennedy signaling that somebody ducked their head.
Sorry, Dipper, we didn't mean to interrupt.
That's all right, boys.
What was that again?
We're just saying that Troy Cook with an ankle 50-50 at the moment, that we'll see young McDonald set up for goal.
John was just making something up here at the time.
And he makes no mistake. Melbourne sneak away. 27 plays 16. Greg Stafford sets himself up against Jeff White, two of the finest big men in the league. And look at that. Ragone may run onto this. He does to Phoebe. Kick partly smothered. Goes down towards left half forward. Viney tries to get away with brute strength, but he's not successful.
I'll keep you up to date with the bench now. Melbourne, Cal, Steins, James McDonald and Collins. And for Sydney, we've got McPherson, Mooney and Crouch, and, of course, Troy Cook.
Thanks, Debra.
The athleticism of Jeff White really is becoming a problem for Greg Stafford.
Umpire McLaren.
And for Jim Steins.
Affects the bounce. Wharf's in trouble. Phoebe rips him to the ground.
Centre bounce takeaways are three apiece, but it's been the work of White around the ground that has become a bit of a problem. He's had nine possessions now, which for a ruckman, including his tap outs, is a pretty significant contribution.
Lucuria in the thick of things there as it goes down towards half forward. Creswell through, but without the ball. Lyon also.
Intriguingly, though, last week against Port Adelaide, it was Steins who turned the game when he came on. So I guess Neil Danaher would
great flexibility, either the young athletic ruckman in white or the old warhorse in Steins.
Sydney have not scored so far in the second quarter. Still a long way to go. Creswell blasts away and smacks it into the behind post.
Well, that'll be a free kick to Melbourne.
It is.
Correct.
He's giving it to Sydney.
No. John, wow. Now John, explain that. John.
Well, I was actually talking to the floor manager, fellas.
You're always looking away.
Oh, golly.
Well, you blokes always bag me when I give my opinion. Why should I bother?
Melbourne's got it now.
You just want me to put the opinion up so you can disagree, Cornsy?
No, I just want you to
look at what happened.
There.
Back to Steve.
Creswell actually kicked it out of bounds on the full and they gave the free kick to Sydney. So.
Well, one could only assume that the boundary umpire signaled it came off somebody else's foot. But as I said, I wasn't looking at the time.
Back to the action with Steve Tingay. Centering ball into a congested area. Oh. Neitz was a flyer and a big flyer too. No mark though as Lyon tries to force it clear. Fine air chance. Bends it back in towards the square. O'Loughlin will see it over the line.
Yes, David Neitz has not quite got the confidence of a player who's had a full season of footy behind him, has he?
Just off the ball a little bit, but you know with Neitz, he's going to continue to attack the footy, so he's going to make a contest to bring the ball to the ground.
Stafford and snapped away by Andrew Leoncelli from behind.
He didn't have to bend it. The drop punt was all that was necessary there.
It's flavour of the month, though, isn't it? The bent football.
Footballers are in love with that kick, and sometimes it just brings them undone.
Two straight kicks in it.
I think for all Melbourne's efforts at the moment, though, they just haven't really got a big enough lead on the board, and you would think that Sydney are going to take the get the momentum at some stage.
Seymour kicks down towards Rowan Wolf. He couldn't take it cleanly. Phoebe combines with Ingerson. Always put Jeff Palmer in all sorts of trouble. What can the Wizard do here?
Yes, they must have that instruction, that handball to the running player through the centre. And too often, we saw it last week as well, they gave the handball to the player. If it didn't get the target, the player was running into trouble.
Phoebe from the throw-in. Melbourne trying to lock it up in that forward zone. Gary Lyon could sock off the ground. He does, but there's no one at home. Nix. Oh, in trouble. We'll have to go again. Seymour's there with him. And he takes it over the line, continuing behind.
Well, the work rate of Sydney has been spot on. Yes. But the work rate of Melbourne is just phenomenal, Cornsy. And I think the difference is that they know if they win today, they are in the finals. They are inspired at the moment. Russell Robertson. Well, he came from 15 rows back in the grandstand and still managed to smother that ball.
Great desperation, but are they using too much petrol?
Yes, it'll be an enormous...
if that's possible, I mean...
Well, it would be an enormous performance to sustain the pressure as it is at the moment.
Barry, back to Seymour. He's got Luff on this side of the ground. That's where he heads. It's rarely been in Sydney's attacking zone, deep in their zone this quarter. They still have not scored. Jason Saddington is a fine young player from Eastern Rangers. Gives it to the leaper, Leo Barry. Runs a long way, goes with a left foot, but his kicking lets him down. Ingerson spears one towards Shane Woden. Thinks about Uzo, who's trying to make position, then comes inboard towards Phoebe. And Stevie Phoebe takes the mark. Plays on quickly to his brother. Uzay's drifted down. McDonald is at half forward and Tingay is just 25 metres away. That's who he chooses.
Has he had his hair done this week, Sandy?
I saw them a couple of weeks ago and it was very similar to that. There could be just a shade or two. Good kick. Now here's the leaper! But no mark, and Dale Lewis is waiting for the hand pass. Now he gives one away to Troy Luff. Sydney out of trouble once again as this intriguing battle continues. Luff stammers his way through the centre. Kicks in towards Stafford, gives the hand pass away to Roos. He comes wider, sweeping it across to Stewie Maxfield. He's 65 out. He goes in towards Lockett, but he can't get a clear run at it because Shanahan was there. The Gurgic hand pass is okay. Melbourne is standing firm. Phoebe chips to White, and he can't take it at half back. Sydney are quick to pounce. Stafford, like a hot potato. Swash is called to play on. He stopped for a moment and then he kicks it high in towards half forward. No mark taken by Stevens. Stevens will go again. He's dumped to the ground by Leoncelli and the umpire has come in That's up by Chris Mitchell, and he's given Stevens a free kick.
Well, there's so much pressure there. The game was flowing nicely. Stevens slung. Pretty much the same way Gary Lyon was.
Stevens kick. In towards goal. Finally, they break the ice for the quarter. 11 minutes remaining in this second quarter. Dale Lewis couldn't take it cleanly. Stein's doing the ruck work. Phoebe threads his way through some heavy traffic. Lewis chases. Phoebe goes for home. He tumbles the punt. Long! And the mark is finally taken by Danny Long.
Well, he's a class player. He had a lot of work to do. The ball didn't come off the boot all that well. And you'll see it's tumbling. He's kept his eyes on it and was able to take it going back. His hands are so good.
Once again, though, it was just an enormously quick exit out of the middle by Melbourne, executed by the first hands of White. In fact, it might have been Steins who went in there.
White's off the ground and Steins has come on to replace him.
Lyon for his first for the night. He's done it. This last week with a calf, came into this game with 34 to his name. And this is 221st game.
And maybe Neil Danaher's a bit concerned that Melbourne are just stagnating, so he's thrown Steins in. He's got the tap out of there, and the burst from Phoebe. Well, I think he was shooting at the goals myself, Jared.
Yes, he was, but Gary Lyon was there, and he finally got one that tumbled into his hands.
And Big Jim.
What a story he's been.
Oh, he's just a great player.
So the D's stretch their lead. Steins and Stafford. Youth versus experience. Melbourne out of it once again. Phoebe gets a high floating kick. Oh, big leap by Robertson, but he couldn't take the mark. Farmer is lurking. Look out. Doesn't come his way at the moment. It's out to Phoebe. He's inside 50. Hand pass, put his teammate under a ton of pressure. Luff goes through, gets it out quickly. The courier gets a hurried kick, but it goes straight to Steins. Swats it out the back door to Phoebe again. Onto the left foot. Floating kick in towards full forward. Well spoiled. Uze turns into trouble in the form of Mark Orchard. He's ripped off the ball. It spills away. Look at the pressure. Ruse tries to tie it up. Uze cries ball. And there'll be a bounce.
I think he said a bit more than that too, Sandy, but there was everything seemed to be in place there. The pressure from both teams has been enormous, and Melbourne just overusing it again, just giving Sydney the chance to get to them with that extra handball.
Still in Melbourne's attacking zone, Neitz doing the work, Stevens doing the tackling. Tingay from a standing start. It's high. It's floating towards Gary Lyon. He almost took the one-hander. Farmer off the ground. And kick? The wizard is away to the left.
Nearly kicking in danger, although he was fairly controlled about his kick.
That's right, Cornsey. It really has to be an indiscriminate kick, and the rules subcommittee have made it clear to the umpires that it has to be very indiscriminate to be paid.
Luff does the ruck work from behind.
I think you also have to pay tribute to Sydney. We're speaking glowing terms about Melbourne, but they have absorbed an enormous amount of pressure here. They're just 13 points down, which is 2 minutes of football. So they wouldn't be all that unhappy with the position of the game, given the amount of ball that Melbourne's actually had.
Deep in Melbourne's forward zone, Robertson is enjoying this leaping. Uze, I think it was, snapping around the body, and he too is wide.
He's having a very good game at the moment. He's right in the action.
Troy Cook benched with an ankle problem, according to Dipper. Wayne Schwoss has also been pretty well held. Four kicks for the Schwatter, who's produced some scintillating games this season. So far tonight is not one of them. In towards the middle. Melbourne have the numbers. McDonald thought about the hand pass, then tumbles a kick down. Gary Lyon, he's 50 metres out. Gary Lyon goes for home. It's high. It's long, but it's not quite long enough. Lewis on the last line of defence. Goes close to the man on the mark. It's stolen by Rowoden.
It may well prove to be the critical goal. If Melbourne can get another one quickly, it may be that Melbourne have finally cracked the defence of the Swans.
Uze again, down to half four. Here's the wizard. Jeffrey Farmer off to Robertson. Robertson tumbles it in towards full forward. But it's marked by Dudley, who comes away. This Sydney defence under siege at the moment as Lewis takes the mark on halfback.
Yeah, it's vital that they get the ball into their forward line. Perhaps get Tony Loggett a goal, which would really take the focus off the game for some time. There'd be a big influx of people on the ground, you would think. And maybe that would be a critical turning point if they can just slow it down a little bit, Sydney, and gain some control.
O'Loughlin kicks towards Rowan Wharf after copping one a little bit high. Well, they're 3-4 at the moment. They've added 1 goal for the quarter. Seymour's kick goes down towards Lucuria. He could be first to recover. And kicks towards half forward. Oh. They need a mark. There's no one at home. And Ingerson takes the diver.
Melbourne are inspired at the moment with their desperation and their endeavour just to get to the contest.
Away Sydney they really come. Sorry, Sandy. Sydney haven't really thought it through with that kick into the forward line.
Uzay, Gaddy line, I think, might have given a bit of a nudge there.
Yeah, the free kick paid, but
great mark.
Chris, yeah. Good enough to take the mark. Dunkley, good enough to take the mark anyway.
To O'Loughlin. Now they start for the outer side with Wayne Schwartz. He looks up towards centre wing. That's going to be okay. He's got Barry. Leo Barry sets up Dale Lewis. Tingay comes from behind, and he slaps it away from him. This is inspired football. Here comes Shane Woden. They'll get him from the side, but he gets his kick down towards full forward. Belted clear, waiting down is Seymour. He won't get there in time, and there will be a throw-in.
And Lewis really a bit worse for wear after that spoil, Sandy.
And looking Jared Crouch also coming onto the ground. I didn't see who came off.
And Collins has come on for Melbourne. Russell Robertson having a rest after that errant kick into the goal before.
Well, Robertson's been at it. His endeavour's been good. He loves jumping at the ball. He just can't straighten his kicking up.
Uzay has been busy. Nicks short towards centre wing. The diving mark is not taken. Oh, Leo. There's been a whistle.
Yeah, a signal given for a high tackle. Yeah. And I must admit, from here, I was watching live and I didn't see the tackle high, but obviously must have been. Yep, there it is. Yep. Right arm over the shoulder initially.
Down towards Stafford. Unable to take the mark. Sydney go into attack, but it's been all too rare. The Tingo hand pass is okay. Finally finishes with Shane Woden. Woden comes in towards the centre. He's got Seacamp dodging, turning and caught. Well smothered, but he does the backup support and he's got plenty of it too. Melbourne look towards Gary Lyon. Couldn't take the mark on 50. Again, the Sydney defence asked to rise to the occasion. They do as they kick down towards Johnny Stevens. Stevens caught by Tingay. Look at the pressure. But he gets his kick to left half board. Here's a chance now for Mooney. He goes into the pocket. Lock it!
Well,
is this the time?
And the crowds are messing.
He's playing on. It's a centering kick. Unselfish. And it's not going to be good enough because Ingerson has chipped in. He's belted it clear to Uzay. Melbourne are out of trouble once again. An opportunity is gone for Tony Lockett, who's sitting on 99 for the season. Lewis palms it out to O'Loughlin. Sydney go charging forward again. Roos on right half forward. Lockett is stuck in the square. Shanahan is there with him. He elects to go short and find Stafford.
And he's becoming a major problem for Melbourne. Stafford at centre-half forward is a key player, vital. Got plenty of agility and also great skills, as we just saw displayed.
Finds Jason Saddington. And this young man will have a shot. He's kicked 7 goals this season. 7 goals, 6. Geez, he's still at a frantic pace, my boys, isn't it?
It is just like a final, Sandy. I mean, the atmosphere is very, very finals-like.
Saddington. 42 metres out. Sydney desperately needing a steadying goal just to stay in touch.
And you can't afford to miss goals like that in games like this.
And Nick has come off the ground. He's just on the phone now to the coach, and Russell Robertson back on.
Mm. Pretty small at centre-half forward then.
Stafford up with a one hand. Saddington, oh, the Schwartz flick on is going to be okay. That looked like McPherson kicking in towards full forward. No mark taken, he's down.
He's made a free kick though.
Gee, that's...
Well, you know, we've seen it many, many times. Darren Creswell then perched under the ball. Somebody coming in, not going for the ball, going for Creswell. That has to be a free kick.
It looked worse in replay.
Well, that's one of the talents. Cornsey, you've got to pick him at normal speed, mate.
Just, I keep forgetting how talented AFL umpires are, John.
Yes, righto, you two. Let's just... Well, he's going to have to thread the old needle, isn't he? no doubt perhaps try and run round.
Quite a day so far, only four kicks.
But that's a very handy one. That's what they needed. Just over 3.5 minutes left. Crucial 3.5 minutes. Steins came on this quarter doing the right work. Stafford has been very good. Viney around the body up towards half forward. Robertson came out with strength trying to force his way through, was young Matthew Collins, and gained probably 15 meters.
I think it probably wasn't a bad move to get Neitz off the ground. He's been running at breakneck speed, hasn't been able to get near the footy, has had just one kick. I'm sure the coach has just said, just sit down, have a think about it. We'll get you back on shortly.
Right hand pass from Tingo to Viney. Dunkley's under pressure now with Lyon. Pushed towards the line. And over.
Yes, but the only downside of that, Jared, is it's just so small an attack now. Jerry Lyon, not a huge player.
So Darren Cowell now has gone into the forward line as well. So another smaller player.
By the end of the day, if the ball's on the ground as it has been, they haven't been getting marks with Lyon. It's a win, and Russell Robertson really stitched up Glenn Jakovich in a similar scenario at the West Coast a number of weeks ago.
Orchard and Wharf combined to push it down towards Mooney. Steins is right there with him. Look at Big Jim. He's pumped.
That was hard work for him too, but he got there.
He'd love another final, don't worry about that. And
well, the player looked as though he attempted to duck before he gave possession, but yeah, in the spirit of the law, it's probably the correct decision.
Obviously, in the umpire's opinion, he didn't consider he had a prior opportunity to dispose of it. Cornsey so elected to bounce the ball.
On the outer wing here at the MCG, a good crowd in attendance for Monday Night Football. Stein swats it to the right. Ruse sees it over the line.
And Paul Ruse, well, we're used to seeing him have at least 10 to 12, 14 possessions at this stage. Just four kicks and two handballs. He's been up against Marcus Seacamp for the majority of the night, and he's doing well, including that handball.
Speaking of the devil, yes, off to Uze. Jared, who's also playing a fine game, down towards full forward. Dunkley stands firm. Kicks under pressure, though, down towards Troy Luff. This is a big ask for him here, and he's going to be beaten. They've got the Wizard in the pocket. They look towards the Wizard. Back he drops now. Farmer, he loves this.
Well, that was breathtaking, man. The ball almost rolled through for a goal anyway, perhaps had he shepherded it. Couldn't take the chance. But Russell Robertson, tremendous kick. Now the ball's running. Just couldn't get his boot to it.
Desperation by
Orchard. Had he shepherded it, I think perhaps it would have gone through.
Good matchup, isn't it? Mark Orchard's pace, just keeping it with the Wizard.
Nick brings it back into play. That's a fine mark taken by McPherson. Plays on quickly to Lewis. Dale Lewis has been one of the more prolific possession winners in this game for Sydney tonight. Back he goes to McPherson, towards Wayne Schwoss, who's been pretty quiet. Full credit, though, Uze's been very, very good. O'Loughlin takes a strong mark. Good mark on centre wing.
And Gergic's just allowing O'Loughlin to jump with 2 metres clearance. He's got to close the gap a bit quicker so he can come up at the same speed as O'Loughlin.
Going short, that's a good kick to Lewis.
Beautiful kick.
Farmer's off, I think, Jared, too, isn't he?
Yeah, just been replaced by James McDonald.
Neil Danaher is flirting with danger in his forward line. He's
Look at Ruse, he's gone backwards to Seymour.
Farmer may just have hurt himself when he collided into that post. Got tackled down there.
Well, Seymour's got 33 players in front of him. And he elects to go wide. There are a couple there alone. Sydney have kicked a couple, two goals, one in this term. The goals have come from Stevens
and
Creswell.
We were seeing Sydney flood the back lines last year. Melbourne doing it tremendously well at the moment.
Lockett leads into the pocket. Shanahan's there with him, and he's all over him. Shanahan at the back tries to tidy up. Pushes wide. Robertson sees it over the line.
Well, this stage, Jamie Shanahan's stats are no kicks and two handballs, but strangely enough, he's probably one of the better players on the ground.
He's done a lot, hasn't he?
Yeah. A few important spoils.
A lot of things you don't get a stat for is Todd Viney.
And four bruises.
Exactly. Viney's kick never comes across the ground. Crouch tries to go inside out. The time has beaten the young man for Sydney wearing the 28 Guernsey. It's half time. And a very, very good tight contest continues. Melbourne a 6-goal 6. They've kicked 3-3 in each term to date. Sydney, a 4-goals 5. In fact, they're not too far off doubling their score either. They booted 2-4 in the first quarter and 2-1 in the second.
Going into the forward 50 in that quarter, Melbourne had 15 to the Swans, just 7. So they did dominate the play, Melbourne, and could well have been a bit further ahead. So this game's still very much alive, Graham.
Yes. Well, that's a significant factor. Have they run their race?
How much fuel is left in the tank, boys? Check the gauges. It's half time, but don't get out of the car. We've still got a long drive to come here at the MCG.
Well, one thing we can say is Melbourne is not going to give Plugger his 100th goal tonight. If you may have just joined us, Lockett at the moment is sitting on 99. He kicked 1 in the first quarter, was held goalless in the second by his former teammate Jamie Shanahan. A great contest, a great game here at the MCG in front of a big crowd. 13 points the margin. Melbourne trying to claw their way back into the eight, have that slender lead at half time. As I said, it's two quarters so far that have been played at a frantic pace, so let's just slow things down a bit with a report from one of our sports reporters in Kim Sporton. More and more clubs are enlisting the help, we believe now, of the church to try and lift their players and, in fact, the club. In fact, there are now 9 clubs in the AFL that have sought assistance from the church. More now from Kim.
No sooner does their Sunday service end and it's off to the match, where these men of the cloth become part of the gum-chewing, knuckle-clenching macho land that is professional football.
What about the nudity? Does it shock you?
No, I've seen a male's body before. Hello.
That's just so funny when players walk up to you and say, "G'day, Rev, how you going?" They've got nothing on. And you're just trying to look them in the eye.
Yeah. Good thing.
Reverend Paul Cameron has been part of Tigerland for 6 years. Coach Jeff Geeshan says he plays an important role and is heavily relied upon.
I have a very good working relationship with him, and we'll often sit down and talk about things or outcomes or things we want to achieve. As I said, he's just been, even personally, a bit of tragedy in my family in recent times, he's been fantastic to me, and if he offers the players the same sort of support that he's given to me, he's just wonderful to have around.
The mutual respect between these two men is obvious, and for Paul, his two life passions often intertwine.
I'd invite you as a congregation to be praying for Jeff Geeshan, the coach of the Richmond Football Club. His mother died.
Pastor Cameron, too, senses the link between the great game and the bigger game of life.
Because it's such an emotional time before a match where it's very cold and stark, the rooms, and this is what I've experienced. And afterwards, you know, there's jubilation, there's a roller coaster ride of emotions. And you, as a minister, you come in as a bit of a balancing effect, saying it's okay, keep your eye on the bigger picture.
It's a devotion that stems from passion. These guys spend over 10 hours each week at training, visiting the injured, lending a hand or an ear. And at the end of the day, as thousands of fans will attest, this is a religion of sorts.
You're right there, Kim, it certainly is a religion. Melbourne at the moment at half-time leading by 13 points. Don't forget, name a game right here on 7. Any game you want, you've only got to dial a number, 1-800-035-665. You can be watching your favourite game in your very own lounge room. We'll take a break. More shortly from 7, footy's home ground on Monday night.
Is there a time?
The Demons at the moment on track to sneak back into the final eight. They lead by 13 points at half time. It's a game that has been played at a frantic pace. We're trying to keep up with it. And three gentlemen who are perhaps relaxing as they prepare to have a chat on the couch are back in the studios, readying themselves, headed by Bruce. Good evening, mate. A great game.
It's a good game, Sandy. No doubt about that. I reckon Michael Malthouse and Malcolm Blight would both be chewing their fingernails at the moment, wanting the Swans to come on. Good evening, Lee Matthews and Mike Shinn. It's been a good game, hasn't it?
Great, yeah.
Nice and tight.
A lot in it still to be played in the second half.
Hello, Bruce.
How you going, Mike?
I'm
you
well,
well,
thanks.
You
yep.
well?
Yep.
Look, we've got, we've got Ian Collins tonight, Mike and Lee, on, and we've got plenty to talk about. There's a whole range of issues, including the melee, the start of the match between Richmond and also Brisbane. We've got some footage that we'll show tonight on Talking Footy that you haven't seen before. We will show you how it started, and we've got some great footage to show Collo tonight when he comes in.
Happens every now and again, does it, where the two teams tend to get caught up together even before the first bounce?
Pretty explosive, isn't it?
I think what happens too, see, pre-game, both sides are buoyed up, so if all of a sudden the two groups converge, neither group wants to sort of move sideways, and that's where sometimes just a little small spark can lead to a bit of trouble.
See the two kids there at the and they must have wondered what the hell was going on.
Good stuff for show and tell this morning.
I bet it was.
Now, another incident prior to a match was on Friday night. James Hird being almost mugged by the three Bulldogs, Liberatore, Di Martino and Ramiro. Look at this. This is before the ball has bounced.
Standing there minding your own business.
It doesn't look good, though, does it? I mean, I'll be interested to see what Collo says about it tonight.
Well, none of those three players were playing anywhere near that part of the ground.
It didn't look like
the opening siren.
Certainly didn't look like a chance meeting, did it?
No, it did not.
And then, in fact, Libba then took off, didn't he, and went straight to the bench.
Interchange bench. So we're going to keep Collo busy tonight. We've got lots to talk to him about, and so it's going to be a terrific program. And we're going to go back to the MCG also and go into the winners' rooms. Just quickly, who are you going for at half-time? The Demons are 13 points in front.
I think it changed a bit midway through the second quarter. I think the Swans will get up.
Do you?
Melbourne in front, think they might hold on and win it.
So there you go, Sandy. Melbourne for Lee and the Swans for Mike. Let's see what happens in the second half. I'll see you on Talking Footy tonight.
Righto, Bruce. Thank you for that. Yes, 13 points the margin. And, of course, a great game unfolding. Melbourne looking to sneak back into the final eight. As they head towards that one day in September, it's a day you too can be a part of.
How would you like to toss the coin at this year's grand final? $2 could make this possible. Entry coupons are available from Australia Post and Rotary Clubs or by calling 1-900-957-004 for credit card purchases. As well as tossing the coin, you and a friend will watch the grand final in style, attend a grand final brunch and keep the $10,000 specially minted gold coin. Then in January next year, enjoy five sessions of the Australian Open Tennis. Proceeds benefit Australian Rotary and the Olympic Games team.
Yeah, stay with us on 7. You can be a big, big winner. We're going to take a break. Monday Night Football continues to come your way on 7 shortly.
Quarter of action between Melbourne and Sydney. Let's get back to the footy.
Yes, both sides are back out on the ground. 13 points is the margin at half-time in favour of Melbourne. With me is Graham Corns, Jared Healy and John Russo. I was interested, gentlemen, to hear Mike Sheehan during the break saying he felt there was a change midway during that second term and he has picked Sydney to go on and win this game. Your thoughts?
Well, I think Sydney certainly got back into it, but I wouldn't have thought on the basis of that you'd tip them.
Well, the game definitely shifted. The momentum did change, and ominously for Melbourne is that Tony Lockett hasn't been in the game yet. He's going to explode into it at some stage.
He's on 99 if you've just tuned in. Let's go down to the boundary line. Dipper.
Yeah, thanks very much. Everyone's pretty excited about seeing Tony Lockett kick his 100th. And security guards are already around the ground waiting for that to happen. But what a great game we've been seeing in that first half. The pressure's been terrific, and the pace of the game, especially around the midfield, has just been terrific. I just see if Neath starts to send half forward, as we mentioned in that first half, he's been down a little bit. But one thing about Neath, he'll give you a contest all the time. And I just reckon this second half, he might turn it around. And young Farmer could get the D's back into it. And for Jared Healy, I just wonder why Darren Creswell is playing in the forward pocket there, because we know that he always gets between 25 and 30 possessions a game.
Yeah, it's a pretty fair point, Deborah. He did start outside of the square for the majority of the first quarter. He's had just five kicks. We know he kicked a goal with his last possession, but maybe he's carried an injury into the game, or perhaps it was Rodney Eade who wanted to make certain that he determined the matchups.
And as we speak, Nietzsche's on the ground, so a good sign for Nietzsche. Let's see if he can get up and kick a few goals. But a terrific game. I reckon Melbourne can just hang in here.
Thanks, Dipper. And Jimmy Steins also coming back onto the bench. Jared Crouch, well, he could be sent for an athletics meet, couldn't he? In those shoes.
He's yet to use them, though. He's had just one handball.
I think, well, he came off the bench. I think you'll find the problem, he had stress fractures in his feet, and they look like almost running shoes,
right.
Probably designed to reduce the impact, but unusual on the MCG on a night like today. And in fact, it looks like the stripes are actually being painted out, so
yes.
Probably not the approved brand.
Here we go then, second half at the MCG. Melbourne have a slender 13-point lead. Stafford had a big first half for Sydney. But it's Viney who kicks it down towards Tingo and Ragone. This is Johnny Stevens. He gets caught, loses it. Trying to steal it was McDonald. Cooker's on his hammer. Picked up by Crouch. He goes wide to the outer side. Seymour, a bit of the fumbles. It's like a piece of soap initially. Finally, they pump it down towards left half forward. Important for Sydney. They want the first goal. Plugger would love to get the first. He'd love to wrap it up with his sixth century as he sits on 99 and Marcus Seacamp hands it over. Lewis doing the ruck work. O'Loughlin lurking and he's dangerous. Schwoss was well held in the first half. He kicks towards full forward. Lockett was there, but so too was Leo Barry. And there will be a bounce with Ingerson and Barry on the bottom.
Yes, well, they moved Barry back, running out of the forward pocket. He nearly completed this mark. 1-2, grab, bounces off his leg, but just can't do a Mark Taylor and get it back. He's been a reasonable player for them, but Anthony Ingerson also dropping back in front of Lockett has been effective for Melbourne.
10 metres out from Sydney's scoring zone. In the opening minute of the second half, Ingerson defends, Creswell chases. Tries to get it back towards Leo Barry, but he runs out of room.
Yeah, the bench is just keeping up to date with those. Maxfield, McPherson, Mooney and Mercuria for Sydney. And Melbourne, we've got Cal Steins, Russell Robertson and Matthew Collins.
Thanks, Dipper. Yes, Robertson was certainly a live wire at times in the first half.
Yeah, but just sprayed his kickstand, unfortunately.
Here's Swatter. Speaking of spraying, one behind.
And possibly could have done a little bit better with his natural kicking leg.
4-6 plays 6-6.
No breeze whatsoever down here tonight. Just a perfect night for football.
Yeah, we couldn't have asked for a better night, could we, Dipper? Pretty dry ground. And Plugger has come to town looking for his 100. Stafford a little late. Jeff White, exciting young prospect. Gives it away to Guy Ragone. Kicked the first goal of the night, Ragone. Goes down towards half forward. That was Ingerson. Gives it away to Seacamp. An interesting thrust forward. Down towards full forward. Delightful use of the body by Nix.
And they've changed the balance down there, Melbourne. They've pushed Gary Lyon out to centre-half forward. And David Neitz has started that quarter at full forward. And he just isolated him. And it's been Neitz that's had to take the brunt of all the players dropping back for Sydney. So perhaps this will be a match-winning move, because one out is a far tougher opponent, like everyone, than if you have to compete with three or four extra defenders.
This could be the biggest lead of the night if Neitz is successful. Out to an 18-point break. Kicking from 30 metres. He guides it through for Melbourne. And he pumps him. Back in the middle, and Melbourne enjoy an 18-point lead. Oh. And look at this out of the centre. They rip it clear as Viney is down in the half forward line. It's sensational to Lyon. Neitz is on a lead. He's opened up that forward line. But Gary Lyon will go back and have a shot. And he's gone a long way back.
He's coming off the long run. But what about the athleticism of White? That tap down to Todd Viney. It was just pure and classical stuff.
He's kicking from 55 metres. The drop punt is high. It is long and it is belted over the line, conceding one behind.
Well, both Neitz and Lyon in the action, so the coach will be feeling slightly satisfied. You make a couple of moves, sometimes they pay off, sometimes they don't, but it does warm the heart when you start to see them work.
And there'll be a few coaches around the country feeling a little less than satisfied at the moment with the scoreboard as it is.
Well, the Melbourne wins, it just adds to the drama and the theatre of AFL football.
It's fantastic, Corns, isn't it? Stafford
who conceded that behind with a punch, kicks to half-back. There's been a push.
John, that was an interesting one. It looked like a Sydney player pushed a Melbourne player into a Sydney player.
Bit of a cannon, you thought, Jared. Certainly Seacamp was the one that did the pushing that we saw then on camera, and that was the free kick paid.
Schwass to Wharf, who's on half-back. Rowan Wharf comes wide towards Johnny Stevens, who's got it almost down on centre wing. These are becoming dangerous times now for Sydney. They need a goal badly. Kicks in towards the centre of the ground. Saddington tried to get the hand pass away to Creswell. Goes back again to Stafford. The big man's in trouble. Off to Creswell once more. Schwass almost caught from behind. Manages to get the kick out wide. And that is going to be okay. But they're stammering as they approach the half forward line. Nix was unable to take it cleanly. Ducking his head, but they're going to get away with it, I think. Well done by Uzo, who's had a marvellous game, to Jeffrey White. White plays on with the left foot, puts them inside 50. The line just caught out of position. Could have almost given away 50.
No, Gary wouldn't do that. Yeah, Gary Lyon would not give away 50, Sandy.
He didn't on that occasion, but he could have. Dunkley at half back.
I think he's the one player that everybody admires.
Oh, yes, you'll get no argument from that. White!
Well, his athleticism has been on display for everyone here to see.
Fair enough. That is reasonable. I mean, Greg Stafford was beaten fairly and squarely in the marking contest, and then when White was trying to go back to take his mark, he decided to claim him by the jumper. Jeff White tried to swat him off and was unsuccessful in doing so. Umpire telling Stafford to let go, Stafford refusing. Reasonable to pay the 50.
But the penalty is too savage. I mean, Jared, are you on the Rules Review Committee?
No, Tim Watson and Kevin Bartlett.
They must look at it. I mean, for what occurred then, the penalty is just too severe.
Yeah, you're probably right, Cornsy, but certainly, I mean, the mark's taken. It's all over bar the shouting, and then Stafford comes in and grabs him by the jumper.
And Stafford now being taken off by Rodney Eade. He'll just make the point to him that you've got to put it beyond doubt. There's no point Sorry, Sandy.
It's all right, you're looking at me. You're pumped. Well, just watch this, though, because it's a very important kick for the Melbourne Football Club, and he's put it through. That could be a turning point. White gets his first, and he's back in the thick of things again. Stafford is warming the bench. Tingo tries to get it out of the middle. Does so onto the left foot. Seymour got a bad bounce. Things aren't working for Sydney at the moment, but they are for Melbourne.
It will be paid downfield, and Jeff Farmer will take it from where the ball will not land it, but where he in fact marked the footy.
It's all right, then, Beebe.
And Dunkley getting a pretty severe talking to, and I think the book has come out. If the book has come out, then it'll be a report for charging, I suspect. And the notes are being taken. Gary Lyon just supervising that the spelling's being correctly noted. And that was the replay there of Dunkley actually making contact after the ball had been disposed of. Farmer now lining up from about 20 metres out for what should be a certain...
Should not miss. Melbourne on their way. One gets the feeling.
Well, the free kick downfield is probably fair enough. But Jared reported for that.
No, I don't think that will be a suspension. And you saw there that Gary Lyon gave Andrew Dunkley a tap on the backside at the time.
Yeah, we might just add that for a charging offence to be sustained, the contact has to be deemed to be violent, and that terminology is used. So the issue the tribunal will concentrate on is whether, in fact, that sort of contact could be deemed violent, and everybody would have a differing view on that.
The bottom line is Farmer has his second, and Melbourne stretch their lead. Mooney doing the ruck work, outpointed by White. Seymour gets a bad bounce once again. Look at Melbourne, their aggression. They pounce on it. Tingay had it for a moment, but then lost it. But they're scurrying around it once more, like seagulls on a leftover sandwich.
It doesn't matter where Melbourne have ever been on the premiership table. They've always had a fair dinkum dip. Now they've got a slightly restructured game plan and a few more talented players, and they are really out to seal this game in this third quarter, and Stafford coming back on the ground. But maybe the cost of discipline has been a little bit too great.
Replaced by Ruse, by the way. Gary Lyon gives a little ground, then goes back into the forward line. The diving mark is taken by the skipper. The former skipper finds the current one. Todd Viney, 55 metres out. Melbourne's quarter at the moment. pumps it high in towards full forward. Big pack of players. The wizard is lurking. The snap is wide. And there'll be no addition to the score as it rolls out of bounds on the full with under 14 minutes remaining in this all-important third term. Troy Luff brings it back into play. He goes short to Orchard. From the back pocket towards centre wing, Mooney. Jason Mooney kicks towards O'Loughlin, pushing it down in front towards Creswell. He could be in trouble. Needs someone going past. Doesn't quite find his mark, although Crouch will find Cook. Spent time on the bench with an ankle problem. Now goes wider to O'Loughlin. Seemed to take it all a little too casual on that occasion. Gergic has done very well. Gets it out to Woden. They poke a hand pass from McDonald. Further afield, Rigoni at half-back comes across the ground to Uze. He's been very, very good. Now on centre wing, it's Viney. Alone. Melbourne looking to set something up again. Rigoni's come a long way down. Look out! He centres it, and good pressure forced him to kick it a little short. It's taken by Creswell. He goes towards Stafford at half forward. At the back is O'Loughlin. Michael O'Loughlin in two minds. Eventually gets away. Is this the moment of truth for Lockett? One, two grabs. Shanahan's got him again. The spoil is okay. It ricocheted away, and Phoebe comes clear.
Oh, that Melbourne crowd is just lifting their team to great heights.
Seacamp gives it away. The D's go charging down towards Geats.
And a magnificent spoil by Shanahan. Lockett had the ball all wrapped up, but he too grabbed it. Shanahan was able to get to it. And spoil it. Melbourne have rebounded. The crowd has got behind them. They're pushing them, lifting them. And Neat's able to get out and has made a big difference starting at full forward rather than centre-half forward.
And the disposal of Leoncelli after running some 70 metres to give himself an option was spot on.
David Neat's tucked in the pocket, 35 metres out. This is badly. This is a lot.
Shanahan got a whack in the calf there, I'd say, in that exchange with Lockett.
Greg Stafford now down with Tony Lockett. He's just 10 metres out from goal.
Wharf's kick back in. White went a little early. Gary Lyon almost taken high off to Stephen Tingay. Hurried high, kicked by Tingay into that dangerous forward line once again. Viney's lurking as Luff tries to swat it clear. They're not out of trouble yet, the Sydney Swans. They get the chance now through Maxfield. Sorry, I shouldn't say Maxfield. Nix comes through the centre and McPherson combining with him. Down towards full forward, but again, Ingerson tops it off.
Now he's played very well tonight. Yeah. He's been a very important player for Melbourne.
Steadies it down and comes towards Phoebe almost on centre wing. This is Matthew.
Mind you, it has been a complete team effort in terms of the commitment and desperation.
Wharf comes over the top of the spoil. Cook loses it to Lyon. His short little chipper is okay to McDonald. On he goes to Tingay. Tingay enjoys this situation. Sneaks away from Creswell. In the full forward of the wizard. He just arched himself almost inside out.
Well, it was a great mark. Was the kick intended for him? The ball came in. He got elevation. Hands behind the ball, so it didn't get through and held it. Tingay doing the discipline thing. We'll give him the benefit of the doubt, Gerard. It certainly was centred.
Yes, but Jeff Farm had no right to take that mark. It was exceptional.
Here he goes for goal. Listen to the roar. 37 points the margin. What a quarter by Melbourne. White wins it again from the centre. Rigoni can't get out of the middle, but neither can Cook. They slap on it. Look at Phoebe. The desperation of both Phoebe boys tonight has been sensational, as has the whole Melbourne team. Jeff White picks it up, goes in towards full forward once again, fisted away from Neats. McDonald is there as well. Dunkley's hand pass towards Luff is going to be okay. Schwoss is under real pressure. Back again he goes to Luff. Play on. Yes, the advantage is going to be paid to Sydney. And so Rowan Wharf comes away, kicks in towards half forward. Dale Lewis lurking there, but can't take it initially. Suddenly it opens up for Seacamp. He gets a hurried high kick inside 50 once again. Scowl comes on. Viney was the flyer. Cornsey almost lost his voice. Lyon is the tackler. He goes again, Gary Lyon. He's at the bottom of that pack. And he's leading by example.
Well, we'd have to have a look at Todd Viney's attempt again. He's not renowned as a high flyer, but he got himself up there. Nearly controlled it on the second bounce, but Melbourne absolutely unstoppable at the moment. And Tony Shaw there, what is his future?
Well, of
what
course,
should his future be?
He's got Sydney next week at the SCG, so that's going to be interesting. Stafford wins the tap.
Trip.
Dunkley yep. goes to ground.
And no 50 because it was considered accidental.
And as you can see in our top left-hand corner, Cal back on the ground for McDonald. Stafford has it on the half-back.
Yeah, they've moved him back on the ball now. I just think it's a bit too late.
Under 10 minutes remaining, and Melbourne has opened up a commanding lead. Mooney takes a good mark, however, for Sydney and plays on to Matthew Nix. Gets a hurried kick down to the forward line. Lockett is still on 99. Shanahan is wearing him like a glove at the moment. Seacamp goes in to lend good support. Melbourne out of the danger zone once again. Phoebe will chip away towards centre wing, and that's okay. Jeffrey White takes the mark. On the outer wing.
He's been the player of this quarter.
Collins is coming back on the ground too for Melbourne. Dunkley, Marks.
I'd have thought he'd been the player of the day.
He has been the player of the day, but he was taken off the ground there for
I think that was just for a rest so he could allow Steins to come on. As you said, the petrol tickets is the biggest concern for a number of those players.
Dunkley's kick back towards centre wing. Starts off with Phoebe, however, they're off again. Melbourne really starting to take control of this game. The Wizard flew, but he couldn't take the mark. Troy Luff steadies for Sydney. Goes to the outer wing, and it's going to be okay. But Sydney in this term, they started the second quarter at 4-5. They have added exactly one behind, and the look of Schwoss maybe says it all.
And Jared Crouch with those running shoes on, you see, went to kick to Schwoss. He slipped, so the first movement was not, consequently, the kick not able to find Schwoss at all. Four centre breaks to none in this quarter.
Goals are like gold for Sydney at the moment as O'Loughlin has taken over the line. Neil Danaher.
Well, he doesn't look too stressed.
No, he does not.
He hasn't been coaching long enough.
what a dream year for him, though. Sensational. Not there yet, but certainly knocking on the door. Jeff White's hand pass into open territory for the moment. Schwoss pounces on it, but then has to go again. But look at Ragone. Pure desperation. Woden eventually gets caught, not before he gets the hand pass away. Melbourne's desperation has been just sensational to watch. And Sydney really feeling the pressure. Luff takes the hand pass, goes short to the outer side and finds Dunkley.
I would think Melbourne have created an all-time record. That is not a great kick from Andrew Dunkley. Unlike him to go the spiral.
High tackle against Jeff Farmer.
I would think Melbourne have broken the record for tackles that have been broken. They have just waltzed through a number of the Sydney tackles tonight. And their desperation at the footy and their ability to break the Sydney Swans tackles has just been first class.
And they haven't used their petrol ticket, Sandy. They've found a new level in this quarters.
Wharf from the back pocket. Flat-looking punt kick towards Stafford. A little too far for him. Schwoss.
Pushing the back to Schwoss. On disposal by Phoebe. So because it was as he disposed of the footy, then Schwoss will take his kick from the same spot rather than it being paid downfield.
Stein's back on. Jeff White off the ground.
Ooh, that's a brave move. That is a brave move when you have momentum like this.
Yeah, it's a big call. It'll be interesting to see what the outcome is.
You are putting onto the ground one of the best ruckmen that we've seen in the 90s, though.
Here's the kick from Schwoss, boys. We'll just let the story unfold. Cook to Creswell. Maybe he can break the ice here. Creswell goes in towards goal. And finally does it. Can Sydney continue to hit back? They've got to win it out of the middle. Melbourne has been dominant in this quarter. Schwoss tries to soccer off the ground. Ting goes away. The advantage is paid. Down he goes towards full forward. And a good mark taken by Troy Luff. He dashes clear, Luff, with one bounce. Over Gary Lyon. That's not a good kick. Shane Woden takes the mark.
You know, a classical case of taking one bounce and running your teammates up the ground out of position.
Yep. Once again, another win out of the centre from Melbourne.
15 possessions to Woden as he kicks them inside 50. Luff is the effective spoiler. Stevens waiting down is there with Tingay, who gives it away to Uzay. Shrugs the tackle and gives it off to Gary Lyon. He beats Maxfield. Back to Uzay once again. Maybe a touch of arrogance there as Maxfield intercepts. Goes against Stewie Maxfield, but gets a poor bounce. Ruse couldn't do anything with it. They pounce on it and lock it up. 60 metres from the Melbourne goal. And little Darren Cowell picks himself up from the bottom of the pack.
Yes, Stewie Maxfield desperate to get into this game, isn't he?
Steins towards Viney. It's like a road train, Todd Viney.
Oh, it's not pretty, but it's great footy.
Paul Ruse is now the ruckman for the Sydney Swans. Stafford's taken the bounce and then he's pushed down to the full forward zone. Plugger's still down there and Ruse has come off the bench and he'll run around with Jimmy Steins.
Well, a clash of heads there and Darren Creswell holding his.
Right on 50 for Melbourne. 5.5 minutes left. Lincelli to full forward and the Wizard takes the mark.
In front, he's playing in front. And the ball came off the boot. He moved in front of his opponent, and so often the kick drops short.
And I guess it's also the risk you take and the gamble when you take your number one ruckman away from those bounces.
Yes.
Farmer has booted 3 goals, all at this end of the ground. 30 so far for the season. 42 metres out. Pulls it to the left. Adds it behind.
Well, he's an exciting player. Just looking at the football in his hands there, some players the ball looks small in, but that ball looks very large in Jeff Farmer's hands.
Matthew Nix brings it back into play. With under 5 remaining, Tingay is at the back. Will drive Melbourne forward again, going in towards half-court. He spears it to Andrew Lioncelli. Lioncelli goes in towards the centre and finds Viney. So from the middle, he'll look down towards full forward, down towards the Wizard. Woden is at the back. Neitz is also there. So too Gary Lyon, but it's O'Loughlin who takes the hand pass, gives it away to Rowan Wharf. Sydney out of trouble for the moment. Look out, Darren Creswell. Felt the heat in the kitchen, gave it back to Wharf, but Seacamp locks him up.
Yes, the running handball game can split teams right open, but if the handball doesn't find the mark or doesn't go to the player who can turn and run into space without pressure, it just stops the team dead.
Ruse, as Jared said, doing the ruck work, beaten, and it's Viney who takes it from Big Jim, goes down towards Nix.
Well, he wasn't just beaten, he was beaten point blank. And Jim Steins created this shot at goal because he just palmed it down pretty cleverly to his teammate. The ball rushes forward. And I think it, when you're this far down, you've just got to try and win the ball at the loose ball and neutral ball situations. And that would mean you're having your best ruckman into the contest.
David Neitz also going off the long run. Donald is back out on the ground. Neitz kicking from 46 metres. Lovely kick off the boot. There's another one to the D's. 2 goals to David Neitz in the third term. Stafford out of the centre for Sydney. What can the visitors find tonight? They will stay in the 8, but they'll meet Collingwood next week. Dale Lewis wants to give Lockett a chance, maybe for his 100. He's still sitting on 99 with 1 goal tonight, if you've just joined us. Phoebe can't take it cleanly. It's socketed out of his hands by Dale Lewis. ...38-point margin. Favouring the Demons. Mooney tries to win it. Pushed by Uzay. Back towards McDonald. Gets clear. Thought about Woden, who now goes to do the shepherding. McDonald drifts it in towards left half-forward and finds the juggler, David Nix.
Well, he's been inspired. Just needed some space. Just needed to be able to run at the ball. And with teammates looking for him, giving him every opportunity, he's really enjoying this quarter of football.
We saw Tony Shaw in the crowd watching this game tonight, but I'll bet that Jeff Geeshan, Mick Malthouse,
Malcolm Blight,
and Malcolm Blight are probably sitting in front of the old set at home with the feet up, saying, oh my hat. 55. Well, he's boomeranged that back. It started left, came back again. And will it be conceded? No. It's pushed wide and just kept in play by Matthew Nix. Finishes with Creswell, who bends it back to accommodate Dale Lewis. Lewis plays on. Goals have all but dried up for Sydney in this third quarter. That's McPherson kicking down towards right half forward. Look at Melbourne pounce on it though. First to it is Stephen Phoebe. Well, that was questionable. Maxfield opens the door for Stevens. The two left footers combine. High towards Lockett. He's got to beat two. He's at the back. Oh, it's spun back and it's slammed into the woodwork. A Shane Warne spin and one behind the end result.
The vagaries of the bouncing over ball. That's the one beautiful thing about football. That, well, the ball moved in the air. Nobody controlled it. Bounced at right angles, hit the post. That's why the game is so difficult, because the ball just goes anywhere.
Seacamp.
Oh, good eyes. Good eyes. Look at them.
Ingerson having a look. It was his target. Cut across the pack. And Kres was quite happy to see it over the line.
He's worked hard there, Ingerson. He's sort of run about 50 metres to the other side of the ground to make that contest.
I think he's been given a big job today to work back in front of Lockett and to get out and cover the centre-half back area as well, and he's responded pretty well, I'd suggest, Dipper.
Steins and Moody clash again down towards Lockett. Shanahan is there with him. He tries to tap it towards the line. Phoebe sees it and is first to it. Stephen Phoebe towards halfback. O'Loughlin, the flyer over Steins. Creswell keeps it in play. To Ruse, runs the circle. Back to Creswell again. Centering kick is going to be all right. Ooh. And the mark is taken by Love. In fact, there's called a play on by McLaren. Great interception by Phoebe. That's Matthew Phoebe. Both boys have done all right tonight. Towards Lyon. Orchard picks it up now. Long and low towards Schwoss. Pretty quiet night for him. Maxfield away. 65 out. Into the pocket he goes. Lockett comes charging, but there is a free kick. A whistle down the ground. And who's going to take it?
Well, it's paid to Tony Lockett.
Shanahan restricted him as he went for the ball.
The signal given was for holding by the arm.
So is this going to be the moment for Tony Lockett?
A lot of extra movement on the ground down here, Sandy.
Five times he's kicked 100. Fans are flocking to the fence. Lockett is on 99. The most he's kicked in 1 year is 132. That was in 92 with St Kilda. Came to Sydney, we did 110 in 95 and 121 in 96. Injuries and suspension cost him last year. Is this going to be his century tonight? 25 metres out, 45 degree angle. Here they come. And he's done it.
Well, I don't know what you think about it, Sandy, but this is absolutely ridiculous. There's people not even running towards Tony Lockett.
Just wanting to get on the turf.
Actually, this Melbourne fans have gone for the Melbourne team in the middle of the ground. There are hundreds of them there. The other thing, it can be dangerous.
That's right. A really good idea for the Melbourne team to huddle around the centre circle altogether, because then it at least isolates them from the possibility that they could get injured if somebody runs past them and trips over them or whatever.
Johnny Russo, where are the umpires?
I don't know, mate.
What other elite sport in the world would allow the fans to invade the pitch like this?
Well, is there any real problem with it?
Well, the game stops.
Well,
anything
it's been
happen.
A tradition for as long as we've played the game that the game stops.
Well,
one of the great feats of one of the great champions.
It was a tradition when it was a suburban game of football, but it's a national elite sport now. It's just ridiculous that a game can stop because of this.
Well, you got two options. You put the barbed wire fence up or you let this happen.
It would be a tragedy if the barbed wire fence went up.
I think we'll have this.
It's a matter of education, surely.
Well, there was a sign on the scoreboard for a substantial amount of time before the game asking patrons not to run onto the ground should Tony Lockett kick his 100th goal.
Yeah, that worked, didn't it?
But everybody has disregarded that. So given that they disregard that sort of warning, The only solution is that Jared said the fence, and I think that'd be terrible if the fence was put up.
I'm a bit with Jared. I don't think it's
No, that's any great drama. I mean, they are leaving the ground now. Okay, we've lost 2 or 3 minutes.
Kids will remember that forever. Kids that ran on the ground tonight will remember that forever, which is fantastic.
Troy Cook is a bit distressed down here. He's now coming off the ground. Looks like the ankle is no good, and he'll be replaced at the moment. But he's just slowly walking off the ground here.
Yeah, got him. We've got him. Thanks, Dip.
He obviously had jabs in his ankle at half-time. They didn't work. But the other thing you've got to consider is the momentum that Melbourne had is just effectively snuffed out now. It doesn't happen very often, I know, but you cannot say it's attractive or...
Well, there's about 20,000 people out there that also, I think they would think it's attractive. As John said, they're going to remember it forever. They'll probably come out with a song Tony Lockett kicked his 100th goal in the MCG. But the bottom line is that there's no way of stopping it effectively.
But half of them didn't go anywhere near Tony Lockett.
Well, the half of them were Melbourne supporters wanted to go over and touch Todd Viney on the backside.
What's the benefit of that?
The good news is the umpires are safe in the middle.
Good on you, Dippo. I think we might, while I start to clear it, we'll have another look at goal number 100. This is the sixth time that Lockett has done it. Three times when he was with St Kilda, and now three times with Sydney.
It was actually during the second quarter that I think Sydney needed the goal from Tony Lockett, just to drop the momentum that Melbourne had built up. And as you said, Cornsey, this is going to rob Melbourne of some of the momentum they have. They're just 31 points down now. Sydney, they're still well and truly in the game.
And you've got kids still running out of the ground. You've got people having end-to-end kicks on the ground. I mean, if this is...
we agree with you, Cornsey, but how do you stop it?
Well, I think an education program is important. Plus, if you have the security people like you do at finals time in a game like this, it acts as a...
You would get people injured if you had security people there.
Well, let's just spare a thought for Tony Lockett now, because he has joined Jason Dunstall as the only other player to have six centuries in his career. Peter Hudson had five, Nuts Coventry had four, Gary Ablett and Peter McKenna, three apiece.
Yes, I suppose we are overlooking what a fantastic effort it has been. And you wonder what sort of physically draining effect that is also with the crush of people around you.
Also, Jeff White's preparing to come back on, and Jimmy Stein's coming off, and well done, Tony Lockett, his 100th.
Well, you think if Sydney are going to win this game, the next 5 minutes is all important. In fact, the next 14 seconds is all important, because that's all there is before three-quarter time.
Well, they've only had one meeting under lights. Sydney won that. But they're down, 31 points? Certainly in today's game, not impossible.
Maybe they should take three-quarter time early, Jerry.
Would have been a fair option.
14 seconds to go. What's the point of starting?
I love it when you get a bee in your bonnet, Cornsey. I love it. Well, we may as well ask you, are you going to coach again next year, Cornsey? Everyone else is going to have a crack at it.
Not next year.
Not yet.
The year after.
Oh, dear.
There he is, Tony Lockett. The only thing going through his mind at the moment is how on earth is his side down by such a margin, and how can he get back into it?
Well, there's an enormous roar here.
Yeah, the police have grabbed somebody on the other side.
Well, there's people are just deliberately trying to stay on the ground. That's the problem. And they're being encouraged by the crowd. And the umpire practising his bounce in the centre of the ground. I've never seen that before, Josh.
Oh, lots of guys practise their bouncing. It's probably one way to get focused back on what you're about to do. And
there he goes again.
Mitch is having a couple. And both gone straight, too. Hope he hasn't used them all up.
By Chris Mitchell chatting there with Darren Breswell after having a couple of warm-ups. Todd Viney, Johnny Stevens. So that'll be a load off Tony Lockett's mind. The pressure valve released.
I'd say, just on that, Sandy, I reckon Tony Lockett's just asked if he could have the footy, because he's had a fairly long conversation with Hayden Kennedy, and I would suggest that he's asked if he can have the footy.
He's got a great collection this year. I think he's kicked, over 10 goals three or four times, so...
Yep.
He'd almost have to catalogue them, Dipper.
So what does happen to the ball if he didn't get it, John? What do you do with the ball when you take it back to the umpire's room?
The club representative comes and takes the balls back. Yeah,
they didn't get a chance to... they didn't get a chance to signal and wave, and you'll see the goal umpire now.
Yep.
Highly unusual.
OK, we'll now see the goal waved.
The longest goal in history.
It would have been 99.9.
And you reckon that's good for footy, Sandy?
I don't think it hurts.
I don't think it hurts. So long as nobody gets it.
That's the other issue.
Here we go, boys. We've got 13 seconds left in the game in this quarter. Stevens going nowhere. Creswell at the bottom. Hasn't been the usual Darren Creswell tonight. He's in trouble.
Well, Darren has a habit of finding trouble, but he also has a habit of fighting off the sore spots as well. There it is, three-quarter time. Well, an enthralling 5 or 6 minutes of drama there. Has it detracted from this last quarter?
Well, in fact, it was a 6 minute 35 second delay.
Thank you, G. We thought you'd
had the time clock on it.
Have the stopwatch on it. Three-quarter time. Melbourne in the box seat to move into the eight.
Now the fourth term from the MCG as the Demons take on the Swans.
Yes, let's check out the three-quarter time scores. A very long third quarter with the fans running onto the ground after Lockett kicked his 100th goal. But Melbourne in the box seat to go into the eight. 11-8-74. Sydney 6-7-43.
The 1998 AFL Premiership season brought to you by Telstra, making life easier. Victoria Bitter for a hard-earned thirst. Cadbury Mark of the Year, McDonald's Double Quarter Pounder with Cheese, and Mitsubishi Motors, the award-winning Magna.
Let's go down to the ground now. Neil Danaher has finished having a chat with his boys. Greg Hutchison was listening to him. Dipper.
Thanks very much, Sandy. Well, you'll be very pleased, Hutchie, with the centre breaks in our third quarter.
Oh, yeah, I thought Whitey was pretty good in there, and Viney at ground level was excellent. And, you know, it was a good result that we, you know, kicked four or five goals in that quarter and gives us some sort of chance now.
It was a big time now for Melbourne. What was the message then at three-quarter time?
Oh, well, pretty much the same thing. Just be hard at it and let's get our hands on the ball first and win it and use it better than the opposition.
Well, let's see if you can bring it home, Hutchie.
Thanks, Dipper.
Thank you, Dipper. Yes, Sydney's still in the hands of Rodney Eade. Well, we thought they may have spent some petrol tickets. It appears to not be the case. Could the drama surrounding Lockett have any influence on this game as he kicked his 100?
Because it was so close to three-quarter time, Sandy, I don't think so. But had it been in the middle of the quarter, maybe momentum would have been stopped effectively. But the third quarter last week, Melbourne were very, very good, and the third quarter this week. So I don't know whether it's something they've been working on or whether their fitness levels are just that much better, but they've been significant quarters for them.
Yeah, that was the turning point, wasn't it, last week against Port?
Their ferocity of the ball has been the hallmark and the feature of today's game, though. And, well, if they can get over Sydney tonight, they are insured of a spot in the final eight. And if they maintain that ferocity at the ball, well, Richmond's got a problem next week. And whoever they line up against in 2 weeks' time
could also have a problem.
Tough job to knock off Melbourne.
Well, they're not there yet, but they're in the box seat.
And it may well prove to be Sydney once again in the first final.
The final term, round 21, Monday Night Football, coming away on 7. 31 points is the margin, favouring the Demons. White wins it, but it's taken by O'Loughlin. A beautiful smother by Phoebe. He's been very good. The umpire has called play on. They go charging towards goal through McDonald. McDonald's kick is wide. And out of bounds on the full.
Well, the young fella's had a rush of blood. He's seen the goals.
And he's gone.
He can seal it, but just didn't quite get the ball under his boot.
Here's Troy Luff bringing it back into play. Well, the members will bring the roof down if they get the first one in this final term, because that'll really set them up. Uze! A big spoiler from behind. He's had a big night, Graham.
He's been great and very disciplined. And he could have gone for the grab, but he elected the spoil.
Maxfield to Lockett. Couldn't hold it. Could be it in the back there, though. Yep, exactly. James Schwartz will get the free kick.
Yes, he rode him into the ground, but Lockett probably disappointed. His grab wasn't paid.
Yeah, if he just had a little bit more of the ball, this is the tackle by Phoebe on Schwartz. And
well,
no
that's
doubt.
A legitimate tackle, I think, John.
Yeah, he's turned him sideways. You've got to take him sideways.
He did take him sideways.
He did try to turn him sideways. It certainly seemed as though he rolled him a bit. But
I'd hate to agree with the umpire.
From here, it did look like a push in the back, I must admit.
I think I might have to agree with him, Jared.
So Wayne Schwoss had a very quiet first half. Kicking now for his first goal. Kicked 18 for the season. Recently joined the 200 club.
Good kick.
Well, he keeps them alive.
Well, he keeps them well and truly alive. And Sydney's last two goals coming from free kicks. Slightly controversial, perhaps. But it certainly has restirred the momentum. We'll watch it again.
And Lockett had almost enough of the ball, not quite. Schwoss dumps on it. Ooh, Jared.
Yeah, I mean, that's about as tough as they get, Jared, I reckon.
Yeah,
well, I think Tony Lockett was stiff, not the inside of the
mark. So do I.
Perhaps they squared
it. I think you're right, mate.
Yes, it looks different in replay.
All right, back in the middle, boys. Sydney try to continue to close the gap. White couldn't take it. Stafford left it for O'Loughlin. They go down towards Schwoss territory once again. Hergic is there, though. Does a neat little 360 with his hand pass. Puts his teammate under a ton of pressure. Are they feeling the heat?
Yeah.
Well,
that one paid from behind, which is a big call from there.
Caught in 2 minutes coming up for Melbourne. All of a sudden, Sydney think they can get a sniff.
Stafford was unable to take it cleanly. Maxfield applies the tackle. Ingerson almost throws it out to White. Was it a throw? No, play on, says the umpire. And White does down towards half forward. Jumper's almost ripped off. Viney takes it. Kicks up towards half forward after the hand pass from Ragone. Dudley is there, and there's been a whistle. It's going to be a free kick to Sydney.
Melbourne just finessing, trying to get that extra handball, and this is a period where they have to grab it and kick it.
Jared Crouch is the man.
Yeah, Gary Lyon, making it look as though he didn't mean to do that, but I'm pretty sure he tried to get Jared Crouch out of the way.
To Stevens, who's got a bit of space in the middle of the ground. Johnny Stevens is a left footer. Kicks in towards half forward. Shanahan in front of Lockett.
He played that well.
Yeah, he was tough there, Tony Lockett, because he wanted to lead to the right-hand side. Shanahan played the angles beautifully. He knew that Stevens was going to try and kick it across his body, out to Lockett's left-hand side, so he took away that position.
Gergic, the flyer. Seymour is at the back. Needs assistance and has it in the form of McPherson. Now Lewis. Lockett backpacking with Shanahan. Almost thrown out to Schwoss. He's in trouble. He's out of trouble. He snaps. Sydney continue to come back. Sydney have kicked the last three. White again from the middle. Ragone. It's a high, long ball to half forward. They'd love just a steady. Creswell picks up the crumbs. Sydney try and mount something from half back with Rowan Wharf. He kicks towards centre wing. Seacamp couldn't do it with the one hand. Uze has been fantastic all night. He goes towards the line. Can't keep it in there of Uze. Pressure from Stuart Maxfield. And a throw in. Troy Cook injured and benched.
And Tony Lecuria there with his concerned face.
Just three Melbourne players have had a kick in this quarter today.
Tingay kicks it to half forward. Orchard had it for a moment, then lost it. Sits over it for a long, long time. A long, long time.
Ooh.
Big call.
Too long a time, in the umpire's opinion, Sandy.
Just comparing that statistic, 3 million Melbourne players now, 4, compared to the Sydney Swans, who've had 7 players with single kicks and 2 with a couple of kicks each.
The Wizard goes down towards full forward. They need someone in front. There's a snap and a goal, the steadier they wanted. David Neitz has done it.
Well, they just got it forward. That's all they had to do. There was nothing flashy or structured about that. The kick came in, two players flew for it. And Neitz, who's the player who you'd expect to be under it or in the pack, stayed down. The ball came out to him. He fumbled initially. But he's been a very important player, perhaps the most influential player for Melbourne since halftime.
2 goals in the third quarter, now 1 vital one just to stabilise the ship somewhat. And it came from nothing once again. Farmer was a long bomb in. But having said that, a lot of the Sydney players have now got a touch and they're into this game.
25 points is the margin. Jeffrey White up against Greg Stafford in the middle.
Got to cover Farmer on those taps.
O'Loughlin. Quickly to Creswell. Going the wrong way. That was Crouch.
Gee, he had the footy. It looked as though he had the ball, but the free kick paid for holding the man.
Away goes Jared Crouch. To the outer side. Melbourne have the numbers. Seagam, a good spoil. Tingay waiting down. They pounce on him. Ruse is there. Seacamp followed it down. Goes back again. Viney gets taken out of it. Stevens charges away. But Uze's got him. Was he in the back?
Paid for holding the man. But I think we could have taken our pick either in the back or holding the man. It was either one.
And Stephen Tingay just fumbling that ball, which allowed the ball to run free across centre.
In towards the middle. Trainer almost getting in the way there. Neats ran into a problem. Phoebe comes dashing through to Gary Lyon. Lyon is 40 metres out. He has a bounce. He's 30 metres out. The Melbourne fans rise as he hits the post. And the Wizard is standing down there in the square with his hands in the air.
And just write down a very important statistic. A great shepherd, I thought, by Alistair Clarkson, the Melbourne runner.
Ooh. I thought the shepherd was from Cow. You saw it in the background there.
I meant the middle of the ground.
Yeah, actually, I saw a flash of green. You're dead right.
I wonder if we can get a replay of that.
Maxfield in trouble. Real trouble. Robertson needs a kind spin. It's turning. Oh. Turning. Yes! Dame Fortune smiling on Russell Robertson. What a goal. Ragone out of the middle for Melbourne once again. Maybe now they sense something. Seacamp and Ruse go after it. O'Loughlin's still got dash in his legs. Chips away to the half forward line. Nix has got it. Has a look in towards full forward. Lockett's got a fly from the back. There's a wall of players in front of him. Now he comes charging out. Gives the hand pass away on Selvedge. Oh, was it touched? No, I don't think it was touched, Ruse.
Yeah. Great play, Plugger.
Yeah.
And when he gets that ball, they don't seem to be able to slow him down. He's quick hands, but Paul Ruse, watch this. He's been watching soccer, so he's just chipped it over the goalkeeper's head. You've seen it so often. Now watch Lockett. He's out of the contest. Ball hits the ground, and he just goes at it. Quick hands, and Ruse just over the top.
Oh, into the back of the net.
So Sydney, hang on. In front of a crowd of 52,614. Monday night football, alive and well here on Seven. Phoebe overruns it initially. Melbourne go forward again. Can they answer that one from Paul Ruse? Farmer was lurking. Lyon is there, but he's in trouble. Luff also. So too Johnny Stevens and Andrew Duckley.
Sandy, just get a chance to update the benches. Maxfield, Leo Barry Saddington, and also Troy Cook with an ankle injury for Sydney. And for Melbourne, Steins, Wawoden, McDonald and Matthew Collins.
And Gary Hardiman would be pretty keen to get a run too at centre-half back. Yeah. Good to play against Tim Cornsey.
Played when he played centre-half back for Sturt in the SANFL. A real nice guy.
Yep. Stafford couldn't take it initially. There'll be another bounce. 26 points the difference. It was 31 at three-quarter time. Deep in Melbourne's scoring zone. Stafford goes again. The big man shrugs even his own teammate out of the way. Gets a kick, but not very far. And the mark is taken by Phoebe. Well, both boys have been pretty busy today. Matthew and Stephen. Matthew shooting for his first goal of the night. From 50 metres. Starts at left. It's coming back into the square and it's belted over for one behind.
Yeah, they both have played very well, haven't they?
Mm. Yep. Dale Lewis will bring it back in for Sydney. 27 points, 13 minutes. Johnny Stevens from halfback. Sydney just wanting two, probably very, very quickly, to give them that spark that they need. Dunkley's got Troy Luff running down centre wing. Luff blasts away to half forward. No one at home there at the moment. Lucuria was the only one there. Now they pounce upon him.
And I'd say the reason that one wasn't paid as holding the ball was because at no stage did any player elect to actually dive on the ball or drag it in. It just sort of ended up under the pack almost simultaneously with as it formed.
So Brent Gergich picks himself up. Sydney get a chance. Inside 50. Mooney to do the ruck work up against Ingerson. Schwoss lurking. but it's pushed wide. Creswell chases, but he's just beaten for pure pace. Melbourne have the numbers. O'Loughlin, however, uses the pressure. Uze was charging, Rogoni was charging, and Leoncelli was charging. And the fans are chanting.
And Gorigoni's done a magnificent job since going on to O'Loughlin after half-time. He had kept him to three possessions in the third term and three possessions to date in this term.
Well, he's been fantastic.
Here's Melbourne's best player for mine.
This man, Uze, has been wonderful. Kicks back towards centre wing. Wyden is the target. Mooney, an effective spoil, pushed towards the line, and eventually Matthew Phoebe forced over.
Yes, he's had a wonderful game, Adam Uze, but the centre breaks now are 16-6, and I would have thought that Jeff White's White. Dominance right throughout this game, his possessions have been pretty solid too, would mean he'd be his best opponent for that position.
Stafford just tries to slap it down in front. Leoncelli can't get clear, pokes the ball in front of Matthew Phoebe, his hand pass further afield to Robertson. O'Loughlin is right there with him. O'Loughlin's kick smothered off the boot. That's just the desperation we've seen. And look at Seymour. He's ripped away from the ball. Robertson, Seacamp, they combine. Seacamp's got to go again. Carl charges in there as well. Gee, they're hard at that ball.
Well, it's desperate stakes. Sydney are not going to lie down and let them have it. Two quick calls and they're back into it. Melbourne desperate too, but that overuse of the ball costing them again.
Stafford poking in towards the centre. Lewis's hand pass is okay. Ruse chips away towards goal. The slews away to the left. Schwoss can't get a run at it. And it's a behind.
Yes, and Schwoss looks like he's playing it full forward. He's certainly camped in the goal square.
Stein's back on now, Cornsey.
White off.
That's right.
Ooh. Jared, comment.
I'll leave that to you. You've been the ruck specialist tonight.
It seems to be the plan all night on the 15-minute mark. Both boys have changed over.
Yeah, they have, haven't they? They stuck to it. They're in front. But he's been such a good player, Jeff White.
Uze to Gergic. And he kicks it towards halfback. Melbourne had the numbers, but Worf was waiting down in front. Ruse is in all sorts of trouble. Stein's there too. Leoncelli eventually tries to get it out and does so to Robertson. He hooks it high up towards centre wing. Big pack of players once again. Sydney desperate for a couple of quick goals. The hand pass goes astray. Lux of fortune. It finishes with Luff. In a couple of minds, eventually forced to kick under pressure. He wobbles it towards O'Loughlin. 55 metres out. Whoa. That's a long bomb. What a goal. No, it's a behind from Michael O'Loughlin. I thought for a moment he was there.
And Michael O'Loughlin has had a pretty... Look, he's had 24 possessions. Hasn't been as effective as a goal kicker, but look, they're always going to hurt you. One step, two step, knew where the goals were, and did not miss by much.
Just let it go from 55 metres. That's a big kick too from Rogoni. And an interesting, great mark by Ingerson. Trying to say equally as good. Gee, just had trouble with your teeth. Here's the wizard! The wizard! Well, they swapped him in the end. Luff clears now. Sydney has a chance with Dale Lewis. What's he got up forward though? There's red and blue just about everywhere. He's got to go inboard towards Creswell. Combines with Johnny Stevens and has the old 1-2 as he wanders through the middle. They charge from the side, but he gets his kick. Not a good kick. Again, Melbourne have the numbers. And it's going to be good enough maybe to get out of trouble. The hand pass towards Gergic. He loses it. Woden is there for the assist and he does well. Uze's taken out of it. Back to Seacamp. Gergic. Seacamp. They will get away with it. Woden kicks towards centre wing and Cal takes the mark. Off he goes to Woden again. He has a look at the umpire, Shane, and he says go. And so he does. Down towards full forward. Farmer is lurking there. He's dangerous. He's clear. He gives it to Lyon. It's only got to sit. Melbourne at home. What a passage of play. Just the goal Melbourne needed. Stein sends them forward once again towards these danger players like Farmer. The wizard. The wizard says we're home.
And Jared, you'll be very pleased that came from Jim Steins getting his hand up, getting it out of the centre.
Well, it's been the foundation of their whole season, the way they've orchestrated their run, and it's worked once again. The fresh legs of Steins has enabled them to maintain their dominance, but the last two goals have come from the exquisite work of Jeffrey Farmer. He got the last one to Gatty Lyon, and that one was just an absolute special from a spin and turn on the half forward line. Now just have a look at the this last goal. Keep your eyes on a very relieved goal umpire because he was nearly bowled middle stump.
I think the bales were taken off.
Speaking of eyes, Jared, I think he's a watering.
Here we go, boys. Out of the middle once again. Stafford for Sydney. Goes high towards half forward.
Ooh.
Got to be a free kick.
You would think so.
And Leo Barry will take it.
He's certainly been competitive. He's wanted to get there, but just watch it. Doesn't hold the mark, but Marcus Seacamp, very crude.
Rodney Eats conceded. Jeff Farmer. Orchard coming off.
After four goals.
Being replaced by Saddington.
Here's Barry, the left footer from 47 metres. Might just make the distance. Jimmy's saying no, I couldn't get a touch. Back to a 31-point margin as Melbourne, like Tony Lockett, hit the ton. Woden. Oh, in a headlock almost with Stafford.
Well, that's just pure frustration.
Schwoss receiving treatment on the sidelines, but in the meantime, Shane Woden to send Melbourne back into the middle, and that's okay, finds McDonald.
And not a good look for Sydney there, with Schwoss appearing to be about to place that ice underneath the hamstring.
Anthony McDonald kicked two goals in the first half. David Schwartz not playing tonight. We'll be hoping to be back next week. If not, certainly the first week of finals. Dunkley held up by David Neitz. Well, it certainly makes for a fascinating finals campaign.
Well, it makes for a fascinating last round of the minor round.
No question of that. Steins caught one on the head, but still got his kick. Farmer was clean bowled on that occasion. And Andrew Dunkley.
Now, is that a sign of a player without confidence or just conceding?
Well, I think he's just conceding the game's over.
Frustration and disappointment, and there's maybe a problem for Sydney.
Well, we thought he was dragged, but obviously not. He ran off quite freely, but certainly icing his hamstring as quickly as he can.
Under 7 minutes remaining. Ingerson leaves it at the back. The mark is taken by Matthew Phoebe.
There's a good setup on the kick-ins. They had a wingman covering the back of the pack.
17 kicks and 8 marks for Phoebe. He's been very good. That's Matthew. This is Troy Luff. Poking it wide towards Dale Lewis. He's got time to steady because he can look down towards Barry on centre wing. Leo Barry, this is a big ask for Ruse.
Anthony Ingerson has just absolutely slaughtered him today, just dropping back into that hole.
Off he goes to Woden and Ragone in the middle. Wants to get on with it smartly. Back to Woden again. Look out! Almost clay from the side. Now watch out for Gergic here. He's tucked in the pocket. He'll snap a goal. That's no snap. That's done beautifully. They're all getting it on the... Steve Tingay having a spell. 12 kicks, 4 hand passes for Stephen tonight so far. And Melbourne well and truly home after Grigic getting in the act with his first goal. O'Loughlin, a tired kick from Michael O'Loughlin, goes to the outer side towards Creswell. He gets a cruel bounce, but he'll go again and again and again and keep on going. Stevens dashes clear. Lockett's on the lead. Here he comes, and he takes it in front of the eyes. Well, he's had only 5 kicks, 3 hand passes, 5 marks tonight, but he's got the ton.
And big cheers in the background. Gary Lyon coming off, and Jeff White going to full forward. Now, we wanted to see that all night, haven't we? Not something we want to see Gary Lyon off, but we'd love to see Jeff White up forward for a little while.
You wouldn't be surprised if Neil Danaher rested Gary Lyon next week.
Next week.
Lockett, boys, kicks for his third.
Didn't play last week, Gerard. You think he probably needs a bit more run under his belt?
Well, he may even be just carrying a couple of niggles at the moment. And Todd Bonney also coming off. Thanks, Dipper. And Well, Melbourne just interchanging their players. James McDonald coming back onto the ground, and it's been a couple of their younger players, the unheralded McDonalds and Rigoni. Leoncelli once again have really put in this game.
Throw Uze into that category too.
McDonald charged off the interchange and got it put straight onto the chest. Kicks down towards a right half forward. Pushing it further afield is Matthew Collins. He's pressured towards the line by Orchard, and there'll be a throw-in. Well, Sydney hit back at one stage. That closed it down to 19 points. Melbourne steadied. They rallied and went on with it. McDonald, a high kick in towards Big Jim Steins. He couldn't take the mark. Seymour is caught. A cry of ball as Darren Cowell has him. And Crouch finishes up with the ball. Collins right there with him, the two number 28s.
Actually, Cowell has been an interesting player for Melbourne over the last couple of weeks. His leg speed, not that he's had a great deal of possessions tonight.
But he was significant last week, and you're right, his last 6 or 8 weeks for Melbourne have really been important.
O'Loughlin's kick goes back towards centre wing. Matthew Phoebe got the hand pass away, but straight it goes towards Leo Barry, who spears it in towards Saddington. The youngster couldn't take it. Barry will try and go again, but McDonald puts his body over it, holds it for a long time, and they lock it up on centre wing.
Still alive.
It is too, as Matthew Phoebe comes out of it eventually, gives it away to Ingerson. They've both been wonderful tonight. Down towards half forward, towards David Neats. Neats finds Jimmy Steins. Big Jim goes inboard. Is this another goal? McDonald, 49 metres out. Where's Jeffrey White? Cornsey wants him desperately to take the mark, but he can't at the moment. Palmer is there. White is there also. Here's the Wizard trying to get it out. Eventually it does come wide. Seacamp pounces on it. Almost a headlock on one player as Crouch gets the kick. It doesn't travel very far. We're wounded. Shane says, I'll do it for you. Jeffrey Farmer also in the hands of the trainers, but that too could have been cramped. And he appears to be okay.
Against Jimmy Steins.
He has had a reputation for jumping very early in the ruck contest, John, but look, 61 half dozen out of there.
Down towards half forward, and a free kick's been picked out. Sydney through Tony Lockett will get a chance to close the gap by 6 points. Shanahan has been very, very good all night. He's kept Lockett to just a couple of goals, one in the first term and one in the third when he booted his century.
The signal given by the umpire seat in the background there was for holding, and it may well have been before the camera actually hit the contest.
Lockett then, kicking from 40 metres, but almost directly in front. He guides that through for Sydney and kicks his third.
Jamie Shanahan will be disappointed. He's played a tremendous game. If you could say before the game that you're going to hold Tony Lockett to 3 goals by the fourth quarter, he would be pretty happy with that. But two of those goals have come from free kicks. And that's a beautiful kick too, straight through the middle. But Tony Lockett will not be happy with the Knights affairs, I wouldn't think.
The margin back to 37 points. Neil Danaher would be very, very pleased. Mooney was the high flyer out of the centre. Look at Shane Woden. He's like a bullet. To full forward, to Jeffrey White and Jeffrey Farmer. The Wizard will tell the story. Oh, he's let me down. Wizard!
Just well, shaved the post.
He's just fed beautifully off this. White's had to go. Two Sydney Swans defenders in the air. That came down nicely. We didn't see the contest in the air, but White strolling into the goal. Just shaved it. Had the policeman ducking for cover too, but I think he was overreacting.
Crouch towards half forward. Strong mark taken by Barry. Sydney looking to finish full of running. Mooney goes in towards Lockett at the back. Well, all of a sudden he can find himself finishing with 4 or 5.
And that's the way he likes it. Just able to use his bulk, keep Shanahan out of it. So hands there, but probably not illegally.
Yeah, it just looked as though he's holding his ground, Cornsey.
I think it's also a timely reminder that the Sydney Swans, whilst they've been beaten tonight, are a pretty fair side if they get the ball running through the centre.
He goals. That's number four.
But Tony Lockett tonight really hasn't led that effectively. He hasn't presented himself as a leading forward, which he has got a great capacity to do.
Well, I think he was really forced wide early in the piece, because I think Melbourne, you'd have to pay tribute to the way they've blocked up his space in the front of the goals. He could have kicked two goals pretty early in the piece, Tony, but they were from tight angles. And, well, it's all worked a treat, I suppose. The third time Melbourne's beaten Sydney this year, if you include the game down in Wellington. There is some chance that they'll play each other again in September.
Would you include that game?
Well, I think you would for Melbourne, because that was the day, the very day that you could see that Neil Danaher was going to have a fair impact on this team.
From the middle, Rigoni had it, then tried to slap it clear. It was unsuccessful. Woden, he can just about break out of any jail, that young man.
He's a very exciting youngster, isn't he?
Couldn't get clear on that occasion, though. So we've got a minute remaining.
This is not so young. He's 22 these days.
Melbourne are going to run out impressive winners, and the club song will be reverberating around the MCG for some considerable time tonight, one would suggest. Sydney looking to finish it off with Ruse towards Lockett. He comes charging out this time. Couldn't take it on the half volley. Shanahan gets back there, and look at Lockett. Pounce back very, very quickly. To no avail, there'll be a bounce.
And great for the Melbourne supporters. Like 52,000 have come out on a Monday night. Now, they're not all Melbourne supporters, but I can tell you in the Melbourne members area, there's packed.
And I think the highest ever before in a home and away match, Sydney and Melbourne at the MCG, was 22,000.
Here's Maxfield. Stewie Maxfield, the left footer.
Oh. Now he got his hand. It looked like a clean bolting.
Just got his hands to it. One behind. And that'll just about be it, folks.
Stuart Maxwell, just six possessions, and you suspect he could probably be a more important player for Sydney than that.
Stephen Phoebe to Leoncelli, who's come back out onto the ground. He's got Robertson in the middle. It's all over. Melbourne are on their way.
And significant on the pitch.
The D's are in the finals. And here comes the grand old pack. Let's go down to the ground. Dipper.
Thanks very much, Sandy. Well, tell you, not the result you wanted, but congratulations. Another bag full of 100 goals.
Yeah, I guess a little bit disappointing that they were just too good for us on the night, Dipper. Yeah, it just doesn't make it quite as nice as if we had a one, but anyway, we've just got to go on with it now.
And on your own on your old teammate as well, have a bit of a chat to him
game. Look, he's a great player. You know, he served up to me all night. You know, we just weren't good enough at the end of the day, Dipper. So we're just going to have to go and have a good thing about it this week and come out with all guns blazing. It's Collingwood now.
You had a couple of early shots in the first quarter. A bit nervous about the...
Oh, no, I wasn't nervous. Nothing like that. Just, mate, we're going to miss one every now and again, don't you?
Did you ask the umpire to keep the ball again?
I think a real ball, someone's kept it in the crowd, but I'd probably keep it if we had a one, but anyway.
I know you're disappointed about the loss, but magnificent effort. Six times you've kicked 100 goals. Well done, buddy.
Good on you, Dipper. Thanks, mate.
A great achievement indeed, and they'll bounce back with Collingwood next week at the SCG. And Corns, you'll be upset again because there are fans streaming onto the ground. And he is upset again. They're streaming onto the ground.
The player's still on the ground. And he now has to run the gauntlet of the players, of course. But the reaction of the Melbourne players is interesting, Jared. There's much celebration, much jubilation. You know it's important for them, but you would hope that it's not just an anticlimax.
Well, always important if you know you've been in the finals. Wooden Spooners last year. This is a phenomenal turnaround by Melbourne. And congratulations to Neil Danaher, their coach.
Yes, great achievement. 17-12 to Sydney's 12 goals, 11.
10, HBA, Nike, Amy, and Workcover.
Extremely well. There's Guy Rigoni too. He was fantastic. And look at Gary Lyon.
into the finals, and he's got great cause for celebration. But so many things can happen between now and the end of next weekend to see who finishes up in what position in the eight. The bottom line tonight, Melbourne, though, is in, Bruce, and the D's are celebrating here at the MCG.